Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of 2016 of the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. Before we move to the first item on the agenda, I'd like to remind everyone present to switch off their mobile phones or electronic devices as they may affect the broadcast system. Agenda item one is with regard to taking business in private. That relates to items three and four. Can I seek the agreement of the members to take those items in private? We are all agreed. So we move to the second item on the agenda this morning, which is to take evidence from stakeholders on the SNH report on deer management in Scotland. We've been joined by two panels of witness, and I welcome the first. In no particular order, we have Richard Cook, who's the chair of the Association of Deer Management Groups, Patrick Creasy, the chair of North Ross Deer Management Group, Alec Hogg from the Scottish Gamekeepers Association, Drew McFarlane Slack, the Highland Regional Manager for Scottish Land and Estates, Malcolm Muir from Countryside and Green Space Manager at South Lanarkshire Council, and Richard Playfair, who's the Secretary of the Lowland Deer Network. We have a number of questions, gentlemen, as you can imagine. I suspect I know the answer to the first one, however, I'll ask it anyway. Could you give us your views on the accuracy of the SNH report and on how robust an evidence base it provides? Who wants to go first? Richard Cook.
Thank you, Convener. When we were shown this report on the day that it was launched, I guess in a sense what SNH was saying to us is don't take this too personally. This is a critique of the deer sector as a whole, and it is supposed to be self-critical as well as concerned about the prospects for the future. I think for us this report is a mixed bag. It should potentially be a valuable gathering together of deer information, but it seems rushed and incomplete. And it is unfortunately characterised by errors, inconsistencies and contradictions, and is, to my mind, biased. It's written to suit the conclusions, which are a council of despair, to which ADMG does certainly not subscribe. It acknowledges the statistically significant, as it says, progress by deer management groups, but concludes that it is not confident that it will be sufficient to meet Scottish Government targets. And in particular, we consider, I think perhaps our biggest point, is that it is fatally flawed by its focus on deer numbers and densities, which we've been told for years by SNH and its predecessor body, DCS, were not the issue, that they are an indicator, one of the factors in assessing the impact of deer among all the other grazing animals and influences on the environment, and that we should be focusing on that. And I know that you've seen evidence from Professor Putman, who is a consultant in this area, which makes that particular point quite strongly. I found myself very much in agreement with what he had to say on reading his evidence. I'm particularly sorry to be forthright about an agency with which we have long worked closely and well, but I need to convey the sense of frustration and injustice which our members feel at the negative tone of this report when they have taken so much trouble to respond to the 2014 recommendations. And the written deer management group evidence, and I know you've had 10 or a dozen responses from deer management groups, I think confirm that sense of frustration and bewilderment, because quite a lot of the numbers, in particular in relation to the deer numbers and densities chapter, are a point of particular challenge in their responses, which we'll have seen. So that's really all I have to say at this point.
I'm glad you didn't hold back. Drew McFarlane Slack.
I sit here as a representative of Scottish Land and Estates, but I'm also the chairman of the Mona Lea Deer Management Group. And perhaps in response to your question, I could refer to one point. The James Hutton Institute carried out a number of predictions of deer numbers within the report, and they also referred to predictions relating to the Mona Lea Deer Management Group, which they did not use. They referred in a response to a note from our deer management group to them to question them on this issue, that their predictions were too risky, that when they carried out their predictions for the Mona Leas, their figures predicted a doubling of the deer population by 2016, and therefore they didn't put any figures in for the Mona Leas. That gives you some idea of our feelings about the quality of the document itself.
Anyone else? Patrick Creasy.
I've been a member of the Section 7 Steering Group on Ben Jerrig for the 6 years it's been in existence. And I'm here today because one of the greatest criticisms on habitat monitoring within the report was the condition of the habitat on Ben Jerrig, where three out of the four main areas were shown as declining and unfavourable. And I came and I put a paper in because it appeared completely at variance with our experience. And we have two very recent reports, both carried out by external consultants for SNH. The first was carried out in 2013, the second in 2015. And the 2013 report really gave some very, very encouraging figures. But in 2015, we were issued with a draft report on about the 11th of November in 2015, which showed us some remarkable declines over the 2 years. Not in deer numbers, because those had fallen, but on trampling, on grazing, on virtually every impact. And at that meeting, the members of the steering group queried the report, and they asked one question about the scientific basis of sampling, but the second question was that the 2015 season was an almost exceptionally or uniquely exceptional year. It was the year when the BBC in November reported 73 patches of snow from the previous year up on the hills in late November. And the previous time anything like that had happened had been 1993. So we asked, well, what sort of allowance do you make for the fact that spring didn't come and grass didn't grow in your assessments? And the answer is, we don't think we've made any. I put in a paper. A week later, we were told by SNH the report was being withdrawn and would be looked at again and then reissued. It was released to us on about the 4th of November this year, after the deer management report was produced. And there's one factor I want to focus on, which is the effect of the abnormal weather. And we've looked at the statistics, and 2015 was the worst year for grass growth, herbage, everything else, for the 20 years beforehand. It appears to be the worst for 30 years. And yet, our report had been reissued. Not one change had been made, except for firming up of all the conclusions. And three pages were put in claiming that 2013 was actually a more severe year. And the SNH said they were not able to compensate for the effect of weather because they couldn't measure it accurately. And the feeling we had, and I think SNH locally now believe with me, is that that 2015 report, which feeds right through the deer management report, really doesn't give any certainty, and we ought to go back to the 2013, and we suspect that the two-year increase in impacts is not real, but just a factor of one very exceptional year.
That's as maybe, but the whole deer management issue goes back over many years, not just one. And I think, Richard Cook, you used the word biased in reference to the report. You would accept that some people would look in on this and say that you gentlemen would take the view you do because you start from a prejudiced position as well, with the greatest respect. So how do we get to the point where for a parliamentary committee and for a government, we have robust and trustworthy evidence in front of us?
Yes, what you're saying, Convener, is we would say that, wouldn't we? and I think we have to accept that that deer management has had to change a great deal in the last few years, and that it could certainly be faulted before, and indeed still can. There is a great deal to do in future, but we're up for it. That's the picture I'm trying to paint for you. What I want you to take on board is that we're a sector that's making real progress. I hope that even our critical friends on the next panel may acknowledge that. And we are getting increasingly better at working together. And although the 2020 targets, which SNH are concerned that we will not meet, it's slightly abstract because they're totally environmentally focused, and sustainable deer management in the public interest is supposed to address not only environmental but also social and economic benefits. I think all we can say is that we're trying and we will continue to try, and we're committed to doing that and working with SNH and all the other relevant stakeholders. We're looking forward, not backward. And much of our frustration is to do with the focus on deer counts that go back to the 1960s and were carried out on a different basis with different techniques. Really, we thought we'd left that behind. And if I'm conveying a sense of frustration, that is why we're having yesterday's argument, not tomorrow's.
Okay. Mark Roscoe, do you want to come in?
I just wanted to pick up on a point that Drew McFarlane Slack raised, and it was in relation to the modelling that James Hutton Institute have done based on a regional basis. I mean, I accept your criticism, I hear what you say, but what about page 20 of the report? Because that talks about the national data and the national densities, and that, I believe, has been constructed on a different basis. Are you critical of all of the data that's in the report, or is it just the modelling, the predictive data? You accept that there's a firm basis for the other data in the report, which points to quite high densities across the whole of Scotland.
I think my criticism of the way they attended to the Mona Lisa situation doesn't give me confidence that the method for modelling can give us confidence for the totality of the report. My suggestion is that if they were using modelling techniques within the Mona Lisa's, which gave predictions of a doubling of the deer numbers within that deer management unit that were not biologically possible, there is something flawed with the way they're doing the business.
Yeah, I understand your point. Mm-hmm. That's about predictive modelling. My yep. point is about the actual data that we've got on page 20 of the report, and I assume that you've read that.
Yes.
Do you see that as inaccurate? And if so, why?
I don't have the document in front of us. I'd have to refer to it.
Okay.
Page 20 is where it refers to individual deer management groups and groups them in bands of deer densities, which is not a very meaningful comparison in any case, but we've given examples in our written evidence of where that is plain wrong. And in particular, the example I would like to use is the Inverary Tyndrum Deer Management Group, which has challenged the band in which they've been found, which I think is something like 12 to 16 deer per square kilometre. Whereas the deer group's own record of counts, which is carried out with the assistance and support of SNH, I may say, indicates a very much lower density, a density of under 8 per square kilometre. In reaching the conclusions that have been reached in relation to that group, JHI, with the data that was given to them, have indicated to us subsequently that they were only given official count statistics, in other words, SNH count statistics. There are no recent SNH count statistics in respect of that group, so without advising the consultants of it, I understand what was done was that they took the groups, not the official, but the unofficial groups count for 2013 and took that as a reference point for their statistical analysis of trends. If I could add to that on the broader picture, the graph on page 21 shows the steady rise in deer populations from the 1960s. And as I said, there is some question about that because the count approach was quite different in the 1960s. Steady rise from the 1960s to about 2000. And then it levels off and begins to turn down. If you extend that line of increase, we would be looking at an overall population now of over 15 per square kilometre, whereas in fact SNH indicate that the overall population is about 12. Our calculation, based on SNH's own statistics with a much less complicated approach, simply comparing the figure that Robbie Kernaghan reported to the RACI committee in 2013, comes up with an overall figure of 10.1, I think it is, per square kilometre. But as I said at the beginning, the discussion about overall national populations is somewhat academic because deer numbers need to be considered on a local basis because management is delivered on a local basis, impacts are assessed on a local basis. Deer numbers are an important reference point for a deer management group when it is deciding what its policies should be, alongside the other considerations it needs to take into account, like other grazing animals, sheep in particular, but also hares, rabbits, wild goats for that matter.
In your own data that I think you've submitted as part of the appendix, there were, I think, 8 deer management group areas that admit freely that they've underreported the deer numbers.
I don't recognise that from our data.
I was just reading your appendix. But
I think it is certainly the case that deer numbers can be underreported, tend to be underreported. Right. The tendency is to be underreported.
Okay.
If you look at our evidence, you'll see that we have used as a sample a graft of the annual deer counts, aerial counts, carried out on the Isle of Rum, which is a single property owned and managed by SNH, owned by the Scottish Government, managed by SNH. And you'll see from that, which is Council of Perfection counting, a closed deer population with aerial counting on a regular, on an annual basis, that the numbers are all over the trend line. And in fact, two of the counts, which are shown red in that graph, are admitted by SNH as being biologically impossible. So what I'm saying to you is that deer counting is not a precise science. It's an indicator, which is important in considering what the carrying capacity of the land is, and in indicating what the approach to deer management should be in terms of a population model.
Mr. Cook, we'll just keep going round and round in circles here, that somebody else produces stats and you dispute them and they dispute your stats. We have some pieces of academic work coming up in the next few months carried out, for example, by SRUC and James Hutton, which at face value would offer perhaps an objective insight into the situation. Would you gentlemen accept that what is produced by those reports would be accurate? Do you anticipate that that would be the case?
If I could respond to that, I think the SRUC exercise has been extremely useful. It has identified where more knowledge would be necessary and helpful. Mm-hmm. The James Hutton Institute is carried out to the highest possible scientific standards, but I'm not sure they've been asked the right question. And as I say, it's a backward-looking question about populations. The Strathcawley study, which is on in woods, well, we have no better way, but the conclusions they've reached about deer population seem to us to be about right, so far as we can. It's a good guesstimate. So I think they're all really helpful. And as I said, what we want to do is not have yesterday's arguments, but to move forward. I think the more information we have, the better, and the more we can work together going forward and take all the factors into account when we're considering how to address deer populations as an integrated part of upland management, then the better job we will do, and we're very determined to do that.
Alec Hogg.
Just a wee thing as a practical point of view. I manage deer up the Tweed Valley in a 5,000-acre block of forestry, and one of the days we were out stalking, we met two scientists in the wood and they were dung counting. That's trying to assess the deer population with dung counts. They had no idea there was 50 sheep in the woodland as well, none whatsoever. They'd just hold their hands up aghast when we told them. And I just wanted to make the committee aware that in best practice it says be aware of the potential error margins surrounding population calculations and therefore limitations and the value of the information generated as a basis for management decision-making. That's in SNH's best practice.
Okay, let's move on and get down into some of the detail of this. Finlay Carson.
Excuse me, with reference to the lowland deer management, can you tell me how successful you feel you've been to date? And some of the evidence we heard from SNH previously suggested that there's not a model that can just be rolled out and that landowners don't have the same investment or interest in deer management. Taking that in mind, what do you think the barriers are facing farmers and landowners in the lowlands?
If I could respond to you on that, I think in the 5 years that the Lowland Deer Network has been in operation, we've seen considerable movement in the right direction, a lot of progress, and a lot of the parties involved in deer management in the lowlands actually sitting down, discussing, talking with each other, and developing mutual ways forward, which has been really good. We have to admit there are still barriers, as you say. One of those, I would say, is data. We don't yet have enough accessible data to work with, and what we do have allows deer management on a local and, if I could say, prescriptive basis, so where there are issues that arise based on data, for example, deer vehicle collisions, damage to crops, damage to trees, that type of thing, then action will be taken. But because of the complexities of the number of land holdings involved in the lowlands, that type of thing, then it's much harder to develop a, if you like, a catchment-wide deer management planning system. And I don't think that there is a case or a requirement to replicate the system that exists in the uplands. What there needs to be is a move to take collaborative deer management, understanding deer management, into areas where that doesn't exist at the moment. That doesn't necessarily mean that we need a lowland deer group in every area or in every council area, because a considerable amount of work is being undertaken by individual deer managers, individual farmers on individual estates, and a lot of work which really passes under the radar. So there's much to do. There are gaps in the map that we all know about. But I think in the 5 years that we've been attempting to try and solve some of the problems out there, then an awful lot of work has been done. I'd also like to say that this report did drill down or attempt to drill down in an upland context on numbers. It seems slightly anomalous that in a low ground context, numbers barely come into the equation at all. But we have to recognize that we do have a growing roe population. I think the only mention of numbers of roe deer in the low ground report, in relation to low ground in the report, is in one paragraph where there's an extrapolation of a national UK figure, which arrives at a low ground roe deer population for Scotland. So it strikes me as slightly odd that where we have so much focus on numbers on the high ground, in the low ground, where we really ought to be thinking about this type of information a lot more, there's very scant evidence given in the report to that.
You made a written submission. Can I ask how you put that written submission together? Because it's my understanding that there was four out of your 11 groups didn't actually take part in the consultation.
In terms of?
Your written submission to this paper, how did you consult with the groups? Did everybody make a...
No, they didn't. The written submission was very much put together, if you like, from the officials of the committee.
And on what basis did they put that together?
Well, basically what we attempted to do in the written submission was give you a statement of the facts as they are, rather than draw any conclusions or recommendations.
OK, and your objectives, the objectives to represent the interests of members to government and its agency, do you think you're getting the balance right between the deer groups and your paymasters, if you like, between Transport Scotland and Forestry Commission and so on? Are you getting the balance right?
It's a very fine line, I have to say. Our membership is actually very small. Although there are 11 deer groups, there are 2,500, I think, vocational stalkers out there working in low ground Scotland. And I would like to think that we carry forward their views, but we don't necessarily know what their views may be at any given time. And I think, as we've all pointed out, there are large areas of the map which fall into low ground remit, but which don't have representation at the Lowland Deer Network at this point.
How conscious are you, Mr. Playfair, of a view that I've certainly heard, that the model for tackling this issue might be flawed, that perhaps trying a slightly different approach whereby there's much more use made of recreational and vocational stalkers, not the arrangement where Forestry Commission bring in contractors to carry out the work, but they would rely more on these guys. Do you hear that argument made?
Yes, and absolutely, we have to use that local resource. I mean, as I say, 2,500 stalkers out there, who could do a job that is otherwise needing to be done.
So why is it not happening then, to the extent it might?
I think, there again, it's down to barriers. There are certain areas where we need to see a wake-up call, if you like. More ground needs to be made accessible to these guys to go and do their job, if there is a job to be done. There has to be a recognition in certain areas, with several exceptions, I would say, but with regard to local authorities, that there is a duty for them to manage the deer on their ground. Now, where you don't even have that recognition taking place, then it is incredibly difficult for these chaps to get, if you like, a toe in the door to do a job that they want to do. But I should say that there are some exceptions. Malcolm here in South Lanarkshire, who are, if you like, an exemplar in terms of getting the job done by a deer group which is efficient, which sets the highest standards in terms of training, in terms of its expectation of how its members should conduct themselves and in very difficult situations, which is, I'm sure you've heard, you know, the urban or peri-urban deer context, which is not an easy situation in which deer management can be undertaken.
Okay. Malcolm Muir, do you want to come in?
Yes, I will. It's a tricky situation, this, for local authorities. There is very little information about deer numbers, the extent of the problem, or in many areas, whether even if there is a problem. We do have a very useful deer management group who work in South Lanarkshire, and we work quite closely with them. I have to say SNH have been very, very supportive. And despite having a small team, their people have been down working with my rangers and various others, helping them, you know, assess deer numbers and all sorts of things. So we're more than happy with their input. The only solid information I would say we have are deer vehicle collision numbers from Transport Scotland. It's very difficult getting any accurate figures from our own cleansing, police, or the many other people who maybe pick up deer carcasses who deal with them on the wider roads network. It is reasonably straightforward to establish habitat damage from deer. In our opinion, the only areas where they're actually causing a problem are in new planting, where it's fenced, and if deer get in, they can cause havoc. And in those circumstances, we will have them dealt with professionally. The other instance in the urban area is where they get into habitat bottlenecks, and especially in May, June, when the youngsters get kicked out the territories, that's when you start getting your problems with the roads. But apart from that, maybe we're lucky in South Lanarkshire. We have a good network of urban green space. Our woodlands are quite connected, and I think the animals can move relatively freely through the towns. So, and with the deer management group doing a lot of the shooting on the surrounding farmland, there's a sort of vacuum created. Young animals can move out towards that, and we seem to have a bit of a balance. As you get closer into the centre of towns, it becomes a lot more complicated, obviously. And yes, we very much support our local deer management group, and we appreciate what they're doing. Councils, however, for quite natural reasons, tend to be quite risk-averse. And when it comes to things like people with high-velocity rifles working in urban areas, it's not something they're used to dealing with. And one of the things we've suggested and we've been working with the deer management groups is another layer of qualification above the DM2 that actually makes sure that people have evidence of being trained to work in urban areas under the public gaze, which is quite a tricky thing to do and a real consideration. Currently, I have to say, yes, when it's in settled areas, we will tend to use the Forestry Commission, who we know have trained people who can go in at night and deal with an issue without bringing it to the public's attention. And to me, that remains the best way. For the farmland surrounding the towns, then we're more than happy to work with the deer management groups.
It does, though, sound a little bit like so many of the things that we hear on this committee, that here's a council and a DMG working quite well together. There's a best practice example. But how is that shared across the country? I mean, does COSLA have any role in this? Because local authorities have a responsibility in this area. We know that.
I can't speak for COSLA at the minute because currently we aren't a member of COSLA. But it actually is a perennial problem when you're dealing with council green space across the board, and in the environment is actually getting representation across 32 authorities on these issues. It's a difficult one to even formalise a policy on. I mean, I thought, yes, we'll develop a council policy on deer management. I've actually stepped back a bit from that. I still think ultimately we will get to that, but it's sometimes not something you want a formal political decision on, because you don't want to come to a decision that says, right, we're going to be a no-cull council or various things like that, which could actually inhibit our being able to deliver our duty. As Dick says.
Okay. Alec Hogg, you wanted to go?
Yeah. I just wanted to say that, you know, deer management groups privately have jumped through hundreds of hoops in the past couple of years, but I sit in the Lowland Deer Network and there's only two councils out of 32 who have got a policy. I thought some have got an no-cull policy. So it's really low.
So we've heard what the problems are. How do we fix them? Richard Cook.
Convener, I'm involved in the Lowland Deer Network as well, and you asked about obstacles or barriers to progress in future, and the local authorities issue has been referred to and described very accurately by Malcolm and Dick. And all public bodies have a duty in terms of the Wayne Act to manage the deer on the land or the land for which they're responsible. And I, as the chair of LDNS and the chair of SNH, have written to the local authorities on more than one occasion to draw their attention to this. So addressing this is a priority in the lowlands. I'm afraid another area where we have yet to make sufficient progress is with the agricultural community, who are not terribly conscious of deer management except as a potential threat to their economic interests. And so I'm very pleased to say that we've recently got a representative from the NFU to join the committee, which is encouraging. If I could just say briefly to why the Lowland Deer Network was set up. It was an initiative that brought forward by ADMG, actually, because ADMG has always aspired to represent all deer managers of all species of deer anywhere in Scotland. We found that trying to propagate the DMG model in the lowlands simply wasn't working, which is why we came up with the idea of a network, because the range of interests in lowland deer management is much broader than it is in the highlands. The types of land use are much more diverse. So the idea was to give everybody with an interest an opportunity to get round the table, and really a rather vague aspiration, but it was to build a culture of collaboration, which does exist in some localities, and you've already heard of the South Lanarkshire Deer Group is a good example. And I've read their evidence, and I think it's very good. But there are a lot of areas where that isn't happening. But it was pointed out by SNH at the start, and I agree with Malcolm's view that we've had enormous help with all of this by the dedicated SNH team who work with us. They said at the start, don't assume, because there isn't collaborative management going on or a lowland deer group in some area, that there necessarily needs to be, because the impacts of deer vary enormously across the lowlands, just as they do across the highlands. So the progress we've made in 5 years is actually considerable in getting people together and in discussing something that is quite imprecise in terms of how to manage deer in any particular location. But certainly we do need assistance, I think, to address the issue of involving the local authorities, with two exceptions.
Okay. Emma Harper.
I had a recent meeting with the forestry people in Newton Stewart, and they were generally positive that the management of deer in the Galloway Forest was like they were meeting targets. But I just wondered how you work together with forestry to see if we can obviously collaborate better.
In terms of the Lowland Deer Network, we have both Forestry Commission, Forest Enterprise, and private forestry contractors through Comfor represented. So we're all, if you like, in discussion. And the development or the arrival of new groups down in the southwest as well has been useful in helping to take that forward.
I'd just like to go back to a comment that you made, Richard Playfair, earlier, if I got that accurately, in relation to lowland deer management. And you said that a lot of good work passes under the radar. I'm wondering what the structure is for the lowland deer network in terms of transparency, and also why you would shy away, and I'm just interested in this answer, it's a neutral question, why you would shy away from the establishment of more lowland deer management groups, when it would seem to me that those structures, even if they're structures that have a different sort of emphasis to the highland ones, would enable those in a particular area where there isn't one, and I understand there are only 11 so far, to come together to share good practice on a more detailed and area-based level than your network altogether.
I think in the SNH report, it actually identifies three different types of low-ground deer group, correctly identifies these. And we are beholden to a significant degree to the enthusiast who wants to go out and practice deer management. To do this job, it needs a lot of like-minded individuals to make up a group that will operate over a significant area. And even where we have groups operating as identified over separate local authority areas, they don't have 100% cover of that whole area or anything like it. So you need a lot of people or a number of like-minded people to want to get together and do this. And that's a commitment for them. That means a constitution, that means a chairman, a secretary, a treasurer, it means time, when they could actually individually go out and do the job that they want to do, do that job as an individual as opposed to a member of a group. But we have seen a number of new groups spring up, one in East Lothian, Edinburgh, which is a very recent arrival, one in Inverclyde and Dumbarton, which is another recent arrival. And those have, if you like, been mentored and modelled on existing low-ground deer groups. But in certain situations, there just isn't the requirement for a group. And one's thinking, I guess, of certain areas where there are quite significant land holdings in the borders and down in the southwest, up in Angus, where perhaps what you need is an annual get together, if you like, a small local forum of people just to compare notes on what is going on, rather than a formal group structure.
I have to say I'm perplexed by you saying that simply because there's a large landholding that that's a reason for not having a deer management group. Our RECI committee actually took very clear evidence about the need for inclusive deer management groups, which involve the local community, NGOs, and I think that the size of the land holding is not really the relevant point here. Would you not agree with that?
Well, I'm trying to tell you that I think the group structure that you see in the uplands isn't necessarily the right structure for deer management in the lowlands in every context. And even where you have local deer management groups in operation, they don't follow the upland deer management group model.
Right, so could you just kindly answer also the first part of my question? Sorry, I rather bombarded you with
that's all right.
in the first one. But in terms of transparency for the lowland deer network, and how would members of the public, if they wanted to check or learn from good practice or whatever, how would they do that?
Okay.
We've already had the point from Finlay Carson about concerns about involvement and consultation.
One of the first elements of communication that was put in place for the Lowland Deer Network was its website. So its website is up and running. It's there with information for people to see. It's a vitally important aspect of the Lowland Deer Network's work that it is seen to be out there in the public domain, educating the public as well. We have a job to do in terms of talking to the public, because deer management isn't necessarily something which, in the public's eyes, is something they necessarily would all want to see going on in their locality. So we have to be quite upfront about that and take that into local communities. We have a project called Deer on Your Doorstep. I've attached some of the information about that to the evidence, which is an outward-facing communications exercise in taking the lowland deer management message out into communities, out to the general public, and really trying to get some level of understanding out there as to why deer management's necessary and where we're going with it, what direction of travel is in the lowlands.
Thank you.
Drew McFarlane, Slack.
Perhaps I could refer to the situation again within the Mona Lea Deer Management Group, where for the last 2 years we've held a fairly substantial stakeholder event on each year, where we've invited local actors, local groups within the area around Aviemore, Laggan, Tomatin, to come to our deer management meeting to get a presentation of our deer management plan and its objectives, and allow enough time during the day to give a time for question and answering session. So we invite Forestry Commission, local authority, members, as well as staff, police, fire service, whole range of stakeholders to come to these events. They've been quite successful. We're holding another one next year at Glenfeshey, where we hope to, you know, perhaps add an extra challenge to our deer management planning processes by inviting people, you know, who are perhaps not quite as supportive of our deer management objectives as our members are. But that's an attempt to try and generate some debate that will provide outcomes that we can then use to insert in our deer management plan going forward. So that's one idea that we are using in the Mona Leas, and it's certainly one that perhaps in the lowlands it could be a model for going forward as well.
Alec Hogg, briefly.
Just a quick one to make the committee aware. If you could imagine 30 men shooting 10 deer in the lowlands, in the Glasgow area, for instance, that's 300 deer. At the minute, they can't get rid of these carcasses. They'll shoot enough for their family, and then they're not shooting what maybe is needed because there's nowhere for them to go. The big game dealers don't come in. So there is an idea to get a wee processing plant up and running where the local venison could go to butchers, restaurants, the schools could come in and see it running, all that. So that's on the go. We're not there yet, but...
OK, that's useful. I'm going to move this on. Alexander Burnett.
Refer to my register of interest on matters connected to deer management. Coming back to there's been deer densities, and there's considerable discussion. A lot of submissions that there's too much focus on the numbers rather than the impact. I'm just like the panel's opinion really on what they think of the counts, whether have the accuracy of the counts. I know you've touched on some of it already. And what you can see to be improving the counts going forward. And then following on from that, what they feel about deer density numbers themselves and whether there's a magic number. I did pose the same question to the panel in the previous session, and Eileen Stewart from SNH said whilst there wasn't a magic number, she did say later that they would look at a density of 4 to 5 deer per square kilometre if you're looking to establish trees without fencing. So just on those two points in terms of the counts themselves and the accuracy of them and when with a product of those numbers, if there is a magic number to come out of it.
As I said earlier, numbers are an important indicator on a local basis as to the deer management policy that should take place. As you say, SNH in their evidence here 3 weeks ago said there is no magic number, and I completely agree with that. And I'm sure if you were to ask this to the next panel as to what the right number of deer for Scotland is, they would have as much difficulty with that as we do and SNH does. As I said, it must be impact-driven. If your management objective is to have regenerating woodland, you need a much lower density than it does if you are looking for deer to be the basis of an economic operation. And both situations are the norm in just about all deer management groups. So the difficulty very often is in providing one level of population for one type of management objective and a lower level of population without fencing for another. What I would say about densities is even if you get it down to 4 or 5 in a particular area for the purpose of environmental change without fencing, you will still find that if you're creating an environment that provides a better offer of food and shelter in the winter for deer, that even if the number is reduced to very low levels, that is where the deer will go naturally enough on a cold winter's night, and that is when the damage is done. So even getting the densities at a very low level, 4 or 5, will not necessarily deliver the outcomes that everybody wants. And I'm afraid, costly though it is, that's where fencing very often becomes a necessity. And as I say, even with low densities, fencing would still be necessary to allow regeneration to take place. And just on the subject of fencing, because it's always an issue which attracts, in a sense, more heat than light, fencing would be necessary even if there were no deer, because you've still got sheep and rabbits and young tree and hares, and young trees are very susceptible to damage by those species as well.
Anyone else on that? That's Angus MacDonald.
A follow-up on the density rates, and you just mentioned sheep there. I mean, what's the average density rate for, or the recommended density rate for sheep on the same type of land? And also, how many sheep can eat the same amount as a deer, if you have these figures?
Yes, it's very it's a complex juggling matter, controlling grazing impacts. And as we've said in our written evidence, sheep numbers have fallen by 45% in 25 years. Nonetheless, sheep are still supported in the uplands by by subsidy within the CAP, which is not the case for deer. And normally speaking, as a rule of thumb, two deer equals one sheep in terms of livestock units, and for that matter, one cow represents six sheep. So there are accepted yardsticks for comparison, for comparing the different scale and impact of the different animals. So when we talk about impacts, the important point there is that that allows us to bring in all the factors that have an impact. You're not just talking about deer impacts, because it doesn't make a lot of sense to consider the impact of a certain density of deer if you're ignoring the number of sheep that also cover that range. Yeah. There is a huge variation, because a lot of sheep farms are no longer stocked. There's a huge variation in the number of sheep across the Highlands, as there is a huge variation in the number of deer across the Highlands, and all of them are driven by the carrying capacity of the land, the quality of the land, exposure, climatological factors, and economic factors. So it's very difficult to produce a yardstick. What I can say is that in order to qualify for subsidy under the basic payment scheme, you have to carry not less than 0.05 livestock units per hectare. So there is a minimum density required to support subsidy for sheep farming. Those criteria are not applicable in terms of deer, which are not actually, so far as the agricultural regulations are concerned, deer are not taken into consideration at all.
Okay. We've strayed into other herbivores, so I'm going to let Claudia Beamish and Jenny Goldruth come in with supplementaries, then I'll come to Alec Hogg.
Right, thank you, Convener. Just to broaden out for yourself and the rest of the panel that question, I'd like to know your comments on whether deer pressure is indeed the main factor explaining the lack of progress, particularly in meeting native woodland planting and restoration targets. And I'm thinking very clearly of the 2020 challenge to Scotland's biodiversity, the strategy that has been developed, and there have been comments made in written submissions about these issues from a range of groups, some of whom we're going to hear from in the next panel. But I would like to know what the views are, especially in view of the fact that I understand that more than a third of all native woodlands were in unsatisfactory condition due to herbivore impacts, and that evidence supports the view that deer are the major factor in limiting the recovery of woodland condition. So I'd like comments on those remarks.
Goldruth, do you want to come in just now as well? Yeah. And then we'll get answers.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Just to kind of follow on from what Claudia said, in the submission from the Forest Policy Group, it states that smaller woodlands obviously suffered more disproportionately from high densities of wild deer. And the SNH report, as Claudia said, makes it clear that that planting target is not going to be reached unless we go down the route of culling or fencing, which we know there are issues with as well. So just to kind of follow up to what Claudia said, do you agree with the Forest Policy Group, who argued that the deer management group sector need challenge on this directly?
Alec Hall, do you want to come in first?
I'm just going to give you a practical story about deer impacts. The committee will be aware of Cairn Loggan, which is up near Glenshee, and it was a SSSI site. Now, the deer in the summer months were up in the tops, but because of the sort of pressure on the hill walking over the past 20 years has grown and grown and grown, they were all driven down into areas, and one of these was a SSSI site. Now, this was sent to me by Peter Fraser, who works up there. At the time, there was roughly 200 sheep on the site, and there was a high percentage of hares. Now, they shot over 12,000 deer. And several years into the Section 7 agreement, representatives were invited by DCS and SNH to go out onto the site and see what was there and to see the alpine plants in bloom. And what was immediately noticeable was the hare droppings. SNH, there's still 200 sheep on the site and no hares have been shot whatsoever there. So it shows you it's really difficult when you're trying to point the finger at deer.
Richard Cook.
Native woodlands, just to provide a bit of context, and this is in our written evidence, but the Native Woodland Survey of Scotland accounted for a total of 324,536 hectares of native woodland. Of that total, 143,323, that's 44%, lie within the area covered by the deer management groups, the Highlands. Of that total, of the smaller total, 33% is identified as being impacted by herbivores. Although the default assumption is that herbivores means deer, it does also mean sheep in very many cases, or a mixture of the two. And as the SNH report acknowledges, it's completely impossible to tease out the different impacts. Now, that's not to say deer are not, to some extent, a factor that prevents the regeneration of woodland, but it is important to remember the whole picture and also to remember that it doesn't apply in all native woodlands. It's also important that one of the functions of native woodlands is to provide shelter. And very often on farms, particularly farms that are let, the access to woodlands is really important for winter shelter and in some cases for feeding for domestic livestock. So just to go back to my statistics for a moment. So 67% of the native woodlands in terms of browsing impacts are satisfactory. The rest are suffering damage through grazing and inhibition through grazing. It's also important to remember that native woodlands are in unsatisfactory condition for reasons other than grazing. And if you take that 143,323 hectares in the deer management group's areas, 67%, as I said, are not in suffering due to browsing. If you take into account the other detrimental factors, in particular the presence of non-native species, which have very often been planted, and invasive species, that average comes down to 50%. Now, my point here is that we all want the native woodlands to be better. The management of deer is an important part of that, but it's not the whole story. And other issues need to be addressed as well, like the removal of non-natives need to be addressed as well, and also the grazing impacts. We need to know far more, and this is where the research comes in, about the interplay between sheep and deer in terms of those impacts. So we're here to try and fix that, but we need to know more about that, and we need to work more closely with the other land uses concerned.
Anyone else? Drew McFarlane, Slack.
Perhaps just a word, again, within the Mona Lisa, we are developing a new woodland creation plan for all of our members, headed off by one of our members who's a forester of some note. This will necessarily have us deal with the very issues that that the MSP has just mentioned there. There will have to be, in some areas, deer fencing put in place to look after those woodlands, but there will also be potentially sites where deer will have to be excluded to allow that regeneration to take place. So there will be a range of opportunities within an area the size of the Mona Lisa for both of these activities to take place.
Just out of interest, who'll pay for that fencing?
Well, it largely has been down to local land managers to do that, but there may well be opportunities for applications to government while the SRDP is still going on to get some funding from there.
But there would be an input from the private sector.
Absolutely.
Okay. Corey Beamish.
I'm just looking on page, I don't know who's got the report in front of them, page 69 at the Category 3, retain existing native woodland cover, and I have to say that in relation to deer management groups, that there are a lot of amber and red lights in that graph still, and I wonder if you would comment on that at all. Yes.
So that's me again.
I know you've already referred to, you don't have to repeat, yeah. Thank you, what you've already said and explained, but could you comment on that particular SNH graph?
Yes, as you say, there's still some amber and red. I mean, for me, the interesting comparison is on the improvement between 2014 and 2016 in those column graphs. But as long as there's amber and red, there is a job to be done. And as I've already acknowledged, we need to do that. But it needs to be a solution that embraces all aspects of the negative impacts, not just a part of it. So we need a cooperative approach to improving the situation further. And the new deer management plans, incidentally, all address this issue of both native woodland regeneration and providing space for the Scottish Government's target of additional forestry, 10,000 hectares per annum. They all provide for that. But these plans are really only just at completion stage. The next stage is to deliver them, and the task for ADMG and its member groups is to go out and now make their plans effective in practice rather than look right in theory, which is the point we're at the moment.
All right, thank you.
Okay, briefly, Drew McFarlane, sorry.
Scottish Land and Estates fully supports that consensual cooperative approach to deer management planning within the Mona Leas. We are at year 2.5 of the delivery of our deer management plan. That is very early in our 10-year plan. We are working hard to try and make sure that we deliver on all of the outcomes that we've got in that plan, but it is going to take a long time to actually deliver all of them. And it's difficult with a group of over 40 members making sure that they're all working together to help deliver that plan. But we are trying to do it. But it's very early in the process.
Okay. Moving on. Mark Roscoe.
We've received some interesting evidence from Norway, where a national policy was put in place to reduce deer densities. And my understanding is that one of the main policy drivers for that was to increase carcass weight and the quality of the head as well. And what's your response to that?
Me again, I'm sorry. Duncan Halley, who put in that piece of evidence, I spent a week with Duncan in Norway this year because I wanted to get to the bottom in my own head of why we're always being told that Norway, that Scotland should be more white like Norway. And I came, and I have to say, the woodlands are wonderful, we have some of it here, but there is room for more of it. And that, again, is wrapped into the deer management plans, making a bit more room for nature. But so far as the condition of the deer is concerned, I mean, he's absolutely right. Deer do better. It's more nurture than nature. Deer do better in a better environment. And that's the plenty of evidence for that, even in Scotland. And particularly in the southwest of Scotland, where the biggest red deer in Scotland are to be found in woodlands, there is clear evidence of that. And even if deer that are hill-born deer find their way into woods, they, in the single generation, will improve considerably in terms of condition. Now, that is not to say that there isn't a role for red deer on the uplands. They've adapted very well to that over many centuries. And so far as land use is concerned, and bearing in mind that the economic and social role of deer is important in this discussion, they provide the basis of a very valuable tourism industry, deer stalking. I haven't yet answered a question on the economic side, but the PACIC report, which we commissioned jointly with the Lowland Deer Network and the Scottish Gamekeepers Association, indicated that that industry is worth £140 million. SNH have chosen not to refer to the multiplier effect of that sector.
It was more the point on the carcass weight.
Yes, but it's correct.
The weight of the carcass.
It is correct that deer will perform better in a better environment.
Okay. And that, by extension, by reduced densities. I mean, there's also evidence from rum. Can I just let you come back on this in a minute? Because there's also evidence from rum which suggests that with an increased density of around 13 hinds per kilometre, as a result of that, there's a declining birth weight. There's reduced fecundity with the hinds. They're giving birth later. There are fewer stags that are born, and that they have smaller antlers when they're adults. So, I don't know. That points to me to being less economic value through higher density. But what's your response to that evidence from Scotland?
The rum experiment, if one could call it that, has been going on for about 50 years, and it produces some fascinating information. As I said earlier, rum is a unique testbed for deer management, and in a sense, there is a part of rum which has been where the deer have been tested to destruction by a no-culling policy. So you're absolutely right in that the findings from that study indicate that if you allow your population to build up without control, the fecundity of the hinds reduces, and the survival rate of the stags, which are always the first to suffer from overpopulation and climate stress, declines. Now, the situation as a whole across Scotland is very, very far from that overpopulation situation that was tested in Rum. And the reduction in population over the years, and I refer you again to the drawing on page 21, alongside the reduction in sheep numbers, is an indication of the reducing pressure of grazing across the Highlands as a whole. Of course, it needs to be looked at. There are wide local variations, and it needs to be looked at locally. It is certainly true that if you take extremes from overpopulation to a much lower level, that there will be some relatively marginal improvement in the carcass performance of deer exclusively on the open hill. But it is not by any means to the extent of the improvement that will take place if those deer have an opportunity within a sheltered, closed habitat, such as in woodland.
Drew McFarlane, Slack.
Yes, Chairman. I'd like to refer to what Mr. Russell was saying, because that really is the basis of the Mona Lea Deer Management Plan. It's about developing a plan that suited the entirety of our 40-plus members, all of whom, to an estate, wished to carry out some form of stag shooting during the season. But they all recognised that the quality of the stags had been deteriorating over a number of years, and they wanted to see that improve. So even estates with strong environmental objectives wanted to shoot some stags during the year. The basis for the Mona Lea Deer Management Plan outcomes is to allow the better quality stags by increasing the hind cull. And that is the basis for our plan, is to reduce the overall numbers to allow the stags to improve in quality during that period of time.
But just to get this on the record, what Duncan Halley says, and I quote, most Scottish red deer are nutritionally stunted due to the effects of competition with each other for food. Yes or no, Mr. Cook, is that true?
If you want a yes or a no, as I've already said, that is the case. But it is driven by the habitat in which they live, in the same way as it applies to human populations.
Right. Moving on, Dave Stewart.
Good morning. I'm very interested in looking at long-term planning. You may have noticed the evidence that we took from SNH when I asked the question about cost-benefit analysis, and the answer was there needs to be more focus on cost-benefit analysis in the future, which I thought was quite an interesting answer. To what extent do you balance up economic, social, economic and animal welfare factors when it comes to deciding to make decisions about the long term in individual planning? Mr. Cook.
Convener, I'm not sure that I completely understood the question, but I agree with the SNH statement that we need to know more about the economic impacts and the social impacts of deer management in the mix that they find themselves, which is with other economic land uses and with environmental considerations, and is quite clearly addressed in the long-term policy document, Wild Deer, a National Approach. Deer management needs to deliver on all three bases, and out with the protected sites where environmental considerations have primacy, then all management needs to focus on maintaining economic outputs, maintaining the employment associated with it and the communities which that supports.
Well, let me ask a very specific point then. In the SNH report, one of the conclusions, and I'm quoting here, management of deer in Scotland results in a net monetary loss for both the private and public sectors. What are your individual assessments of that quote?
I see you're more encouraged
with that question.
My assessment is that I challenge it because SNH have chosen the direct spend effects, the primary expenditure, primary income figures from that report, which was carried out by an independent economic consultancy who have done many other rural sector studies in the past and have a very good track record using a normal economic model based on questionnaires and surveys. They've chosen to ignore the multiplier effect. And in comparing the impact of any sector on the rural economy, the national economy, it is important to get the trickle-down effect. So I do challenge the way they've used those figures. I think one of the interesting figures they've picked out is that 36.8 million, if I remember correctly, was the cost of deer management to the private sector, alongside, I think, a total of 5.2 million of public sector expenditure per annum on deer management. It does just raise the question as to how we are going to pay for deer management in future if we do not do so with the present model, because more of that cost will shift to the public sector if less independence under the voluntary principle is left to the private sector. It's a very considerable annual cost. SNH at the moment estimate their allocation of cost to deer management is 1.5 million, which is considerably less than Forest Enterprise because they're managing far more land. But those costs together are really a small proportion of the total cost of the industry, which I think comes to £42.5 million per annum.
If I can perhaps set the context a bit better, when I was raising the question to SNH, it was around, in really simplistic terms, about culling versus fencing. And I think the point I was making at the time, and I'm grateful to the convener for a statistic here, is that since 1990, 13,500 kilometres of fencing has been developed, which is the same distance as from here to Cape Town. And you'll be glad to know that prepared that earlier. It's not something I tend to know off the top of my head. But that's going to be £250 million pounds over a 10-year period, which is a phenomenal cost. So that was the background to my question of cost-benefit. Mr. Cook?
Fencing, yes. to remove it a moment from the deer context, you have to speculate to accumulate, and any business expects to invest in its capital. In the case of afforestation or woodland protection, the capital is very often fencing. Nobody wants to spend £12 a metre if they don't have to. They do it because it is necessary to do so in the pattern of land use in the area. Mm. And fencing is not just about deer, as I said earlier. It's also about excluding other herbivores, albeit the cost of stock fencing with rabbit netting is only 2/3 of the cost of deer fencing. So, and I would say that culling and fencing are not alternatives, they're complementaries. Mm-hmm. And it has been the practice of the Deer Commission for Scotland to recommend for probably 25, 30 years that if you are enclosing a piece of ground and removing it from the deer range for another purpose, in particular afforestation, that a compensatory cull should be taken so that you aren't increasing the density of population out with the fence. And you know that is normal practice and is taken into account in every land management change where deer and, for that matter, stock are an issue.
I'll bring up the other panellists as well. I'm conscious of time, but could you maybe say something around the point I raised about the amount of fencing that's been built since 1990, because there's clear issues about maintenance for that, isn't there? And that's a huge cost.
Absolutely. And as I said earlier, you speculate to accumulate. If you invest capital in a business, then you need to maintain the equipment that you've bought with it. In the case of fencing, maintenance is absolutely essential. Deer are pretty ingenious when it comes to finding a way round a fence or under a fence or over a fence when the snow is high. So maintenance is absolutely necessary, and there's a very considerable cost associated with that. And as Drew McFarlane Slack said not long ago, a great deal of that fencing is private, albeit it may be carried out under a grant scheme where some public money is involved. A lot of the fencing is also state fencing in the sense that it is erected by Forest Enterprise. Forest Enterprise have invested a great deal over recent years in recharging their fence stock. They have replaced a lot of fences, put up a lot of new ones. Their policy is changing as we get into second rotation forestry, in that what they are now tending to do is to erect a perimeter fence and maintain it resolutely, rather than trying to fence small parcels. So the amount of fencing per hectare of established woodland is actually declining. But the quality of the fencing and the quality of its maintenance needs to be better. Mm. And within those fences, Forest Enterprise, quite rightly on our behalf as the taxpayer paying them to grow trees, take a very, very rigorous approach to the presence of deer and cull them down to a level where the casualty rate in terms of leaders on trees is below 10%. Mm. And there are some areas where they're achieving that, some areas where they're not.
And perhaps bring other, I don't know if Mr. Hogg wants to comment, but is there any statistics done on what the average shelf life would be of fencing? In other words, if you put fencing up today, what would your expectation be of the time that that fence would be effective. Mr. Hogg?
15 years, maybe, and then needs repaired. But what surprises me, when we started the way back with the deer, the government paid £7 million to have fences taken down to save our cap or Kayleigh. And that was when the first issue started with argument with the deer and trees, because a lot of those, and they must have been taken more down than what they've put up for to save the capper, and the capper are still diving down.
Okay. Is that, anyone else like to come in on?
I would probably guess that in many areas the fences will last longer than 15 years with simple maintenance and checks. Certainly experience in my area is that 25 years a protection fence will still be in good condition.
Okay, right.
I think it probably depends on the quality of the timber, the basis of the fence, whether that timber has been impregnated with anti-rotting chemicals to keep it in good condition for a longer period of time. You know, if the quality is good, then it certainly should last 25 years or more even.
Thank you.
Let's move this on. Kate Forbes.
I'd like to ask a question about deer management plans. The reason we're here today is that in 2014, it was agreed that a reasonable time frame for all DMGs to have adopted a plan was by the end of 2016, and those plans should be environmentally responsible and able to demonstrate how they were delivering positive outcomes for deer population and natural heritage. But in the SNH report, there's a suggestion that plans are not leading to action on the ground. Some DMGs in written evidence have made the point that impact takes time. So what is the panel's view? Are the majority of plans environmentally responsible and delivering change? And have groups had enough time?
Look at a couple of stats, because you've been quoting stats at us most of the morning. The report actually claims that fewer than 50% of the DMG plans adequately identify actions to manage herbivore impacts on designated features or improve native woodland condition, and fewer than 25% adequately identify sustainable levels of grazing for habitats in the wider countryside. Are those figures accurate?
The figures are based on the assessment process, which was carried out as a baseline exercise towards the end of 2014 and repeated in May, June this year, to assess in very close detail the progress made by deer management groups. As you'll have seen from the report, the general picture is one of considerable improvement, statistically significant improvement. That is not to say that all deer management plans are yet scoring 100%. How many of us scored 100% in the school exam? This is an ongoing process. Some groups are a lot further forward than others. The others are moving forward rapidly. There are a number of groups that do not yet have completed plans, but they're working on them, and a number of new ones emerging all the time that will continue to make progress. This deer management plans will never be, there is no destination. This is an ongoing adaptive process. Deer management plans will need to adapt to circumstances and will need to continue to show more progress. It's ADMG's job to assist deer management groups in making that progress, and as we have up till now, and we'll continue to do that.
This isn't about necessarily delivering the progress. This is about actually identifying something in the plan by way of action to take.
Agreed, and that's an important distinction, because as Kate Forbes said at the beginning, the task was set to create plans in a short space of time, a couple of years, that were environmentally responsible, identified the public interest, were open and consultative with the public. And as I am happy to acknowledge, we're a very long way from being able to say that in respect of all plans. What I am able to say to you is that almost without exception, in fact, I'm not able to identify an exception, the deer management groups have taken that on board, and with the resources available to them, which is very often voluntary time, I may say, are moving in that direction. And have achieved a very considerable amount.
Can I just ask a supplementary to that in terms of the differentiation in some of the plans? Pinning that down, what are the reasons for why plans have varied in their successes?
As you said yourself at the beginning, this first stage is to create plans which address all the points of public interest. Some of them are better than others.
Why are some better than others?
I suspect because the creation of a plan is an iterative process. Probably the best ones are the ones where they've been created by an independent consultant, and not just because they know more, because they don't necessarily, but because they provide an external objective means to address all the issues, to speak to all the individual members of the group and identify what their management objectives are, put them into the soup bowl and come up with something that works for everybody. Other groups have adapted existing plans without the assistance of experts and with input, so that their main source of external guidance has been from the SNH Wildlife Management Offices, which has been extremely good. Those are the ones which I suspect are towards the bottom of the spectrum in terms of distance travelled so far. But none of them are a basket case. None of them are not trying. And I would point out to one of the examples made in the report of a failing deer management group, which in fact is the Harrison Lewis group, which they said scored, I think, 76% red and no greens in terms of public interest. That's one way to tell the story. The other way to tell the story is that this is a group which was no more than a nominal group for the years leading up to 2015 when they got going. They have now got the message, employed a consultant to write a deer management plan, started having meetings, getting people to buy into it. So this is a success story. It's got a long way to go before you can say that it works. But this is a good example of where a gap is being filled. The SNH has rightly observed that there are gaps, but this is a good example of where that gap is being addressed and filled. We have identified other areas where that is necessary, which haven't even yet started, but we'll do so.
Does anybody else want to come in?
Yes, Chairman. I thank Kate Forbes for a question because, I think at the moment we now have fairly wide coverage of Scotland with deer management plans. Even if those plans are a mixed bag, we have plans that can be monitored now. So even the ones that aren't as good as the best can be made better by proper monitoring by the groups themselves and by SNH supporting them. I think the Monalea Deer Management Group probably, hopefully, sits in the first group that Richard referred to there. We do have a plan that was assisted by an external advisor. All of our members were contacted and interviewed prior to the plan being put in place. The plan, as I mentioned earlier in answering a question, is only 2.5 years old. So we're at a very early stage in the development of our plan. And for the last 2 years, we have been concentrating on what we collectively believe has been the most important issue facing us, and that is controlling the deer herd within our group. There are other issues that we've been dealing with, and I referred again to our stakeholder engagement programme. We've got a training day for our members set up for early in January this year coming. All of the other public benefits that are as part of our plan are being dealt with systematically, and they will be looked at and considered at the end of the first 5 years of our plan, and those that we feel that we haven't tackled properly will again be tackled at that stage. We are looking at this plan over a 10-year period to deliver all of the objectives that we hope that will deliver the public benefits that SNH are looking for. But we are very early in this programme and we haven't had enough time to deliver it all yet. And I think we are one of the better groups.
With respect, that's really concerning because the evidence we're hearing today and in writing talks about, we keep being told it's too early to judge progress. Indeed, the British Deer Society wants us to wait another 7 to 10 years for a review before we come to judgment on this. Just how long, collectively, I'm not having a go at your own deer management plan, Mr. McFarlane. So how long collectively do you and SNH need to sort this?
Well, if you're asking me that, I think we need to be tested in this at the end of our first 5 years. So I would say another 2.5 years would give us the ability to say yes or no, we are making this work. And I have a great deal of confidence that we will make this work. But it may take more time for some of these groups that are setting off from a lower standpoint than ourselves.
Alec Hogg.
I spoke with Brian Lyle, who's a stalker up at Badenloch in Sutherland last night on the phone, and Brian's been there for 40 years. And he said since he's been working with SNH, they've changed the bar 3 times as far as habitat assessment goes. Okay. So they haven't got their head around that. He says Ray Mears was up doing a programme, a documentary, and he was telling the public how this habitat takes thousands of years to get to where it is, yet SNH want it sorted in 2 years. They're not living in the real world.
But it's many years of decline that have got us to that position in the first place.
But you've got to make a start to get it back, but it takes years and years and years on the hill because it's so exposed to see a difference.
Okay, let's move on and look at some of the tools that are available or ought to be deployed by SNH in this regard. Let's look at Section 7s, for example. Mr. Cook, in evidence to the RACI Committee in 2013, you described Section 7s as an enormous success. Yet the SNH report states that of the 11 agreements, and there's a dispute whether it's 11 I accept at the moment, deer density targets have been met for only 6, habitat targets have only been met fully for 3, It also asserts that where Section 7 agreements were established in DMGs where there were concerns over deer impacts on natural features, the proportion of features in favourable and unfavourable recovering condition is 7% lower than in non-Section 7 areas. Now, I'll accept that there's a Bradalbin DMG, for example, take issue with some of the claims made about them. But do you still hold to that view, Mr. Cook, and do others on the panel believe that Section 7s work?
Yes, I do hold to that view. I mean, it's an ongoing process, so we haven't. There is more to do, and it's incidentally the minister at the time, Paul Wheelhouse, held to the same view in his response to the RACI committee, and that reflected the view of SNH at the time. So they have now, for some reason, taken a rather more negative view of Section 7. There are a number of signs of real progress in the Section 7 areas. You've heard from Patrick Creasy earlier that teasing out the actual progress being made and how it's being monitored is in itself an issue. But Section 7 has, in a sense, it's a Section 7 agreement is a mini deer management plan that's anchored to a specific designated site. It's a very similar process. And the great thing in my mind, when I made that remark, what I had in mind was that putting in a Section 7 agreement, which is a voluntary control agreement, brings together all the relevant interests, makes them consider all the factors at play, and makes them come up with a collective solution to the problem. It may take some time to deliver, but there have been most, as you say, some of the groups have yet to achieve their cull targets. Some of them are older than others. One or two Section 7s, which haven't even been mentioned here, and I'm thinking of the one in Glen Isla, was set up at the behest of the deer group in the area because they were unable to control the population because they were fleeing into the woods. Now, that Section 7 agreement was actually closed down, having been a success. The Bradalbin one, which is referred to there, was actually closed in 2015, despite what it says in the report. So there are different ways of looking at this.
With respect, we've been talking a few moments ago about needing time to deliver. All but one of these Section 7 agreements predates SNH taking responsibility for for deer management. So these are not new developments. These have had years to be implemented, and they're not working based on that evidence. Would you not accept that?
Some of them have a long way to go. Some of them have worked. Some of them are work in progress. I do accept that.
But you've had quite... Well, sorry, not you, but they've had quite a few years to develop these.
It has been Section 7 has been available since the 1996 Deer Act. It's interesting that SNH, since they became responsible for deer management, have not sought to put in place any new Section 7s, they have a small number.
One.
But most of those were set up by the Deer Commission. And I, as I keep saying, I don't want to sound like a broken record. Very often, and in particular in some of these cases, such as the Breadalbane one and the Killochan one that Alec Hogg has referred to, it's not just about dealing with the deer issue. It's about addressing all the factors at play.
Drew McFarlane, Slack.
Chairman, just a point that that Richard Cook made there about Section 7 being a mini deer management plan. I'd like to just turn that on its face for a second. I mean, it's my opinion, it's been my opinion that deer management plans are in themselves almost surrogate Section 7 agreements. They are, you know, able to be monitored, they are voluntary, but they are operating almost as a surrogate Section 7 agreement. And that is why I think it's important that that members of this committee should realise that the steps that we've taken to date to get more deer management groups to develop their plans is a huge step forward than we had even 3 or 4 years ago.
Patrick Creasy.
Might I say that on Ben Jerrig, which is the second biggest of the Section 7 agreement areas, the report suggests that it's not working. 3 out of the 4 main categories are failing. We have a very recent report commissioned for SNH in 2013, which surveyed in depth 4 main habitat features, concluded that 3 out of 4 were in good condition, and then it did a more local check on a further 9, and 8 out of 9 noted were in favourable condition. I would say that there are very real reasons for challenging the conclusions in our most recent deer management report.
That's in relation to that particular Section 7?
A particular Section 7, but that is one of the biggest factors that comes together to the overall conclusion. Okay. I'm pretty sure that SNH will go and review the data we've already got. We're not challenging the data. It has been very useful in many cases. And I was out last week on a collaborative exercise on SNH to address a small problem in a very inaccessible area, which came directly from seeing where the greatest habitat impacts were concentrated. But because we had this extraordinary 2015, it also affected the Fannix, it might have affected elsewhere. We have a series of reports whose conclusions have been harvested, I think, without proper scientific review, and may well be wrong. But I can't say that they are wrong, but a natural system with wild deer, land and all the rest doesn't respond that quickly. It takes a very, very long time to see where it's going. We have misleading information in this year's report to the stage that we need to check it further before we set our plans clearly as to where we're going.
Just out of interest then, has there been any stage in the preceding years when any of these Section 7s that we're referring to were actually hitting those targets prior to 2015 that we're aware of?
As I say, some Section 7s have been discharged. They have been brought into existence, have done what they were intended to do.
I'm talking about these real live ones that are still on the go now. If we accept Mr. Creasy's point that there was a bad year, you're making a judgment on that snapshot. Was there any point in 2013, 2012, 2014 when they might have looked at these Section 7s and been able to say, well, in this regard, they are hitting their targets?
If you take the Kinlochan Section 7, which was referred to earlier, as an example, the reduction targets there, and this is a slightly unusual situation where the impact is a summer situation rather than the winter one, where the deer all congregate on the high ground and their impacts there are causing damage to an important nature reserve. The targets were reached over a period of about 5 years, I think now about 5 years ago. That was considered by SNH and the participating bodies as not having led to the improvements that were expected. So it was adjusted and a further cull was taken. If you look at the other, another example, the West Ross Deer Management Group, the Fannock Hills SSSI, on which you received some evidence from the chairman of the West Ross Deer Management Group, Randall Wilson. The situation there, as it says in the SNH report, is that they have achieved their cull target, but again, at this stage, the SNH and their surveyors and the group are concerned that it may not have been enough, so they're revisiting it. As I say, Section 7s are an adaptive process. They need to respond to the evidence as it comes in, taking into account, as has been said, the length of time that it takes for a change in management to be reflected in the quality of the vegetation on the ground in very exposed locations sometimes.
Okay. Let's look on Section 8s now. Angus MacDonald.
Convener, when SNH gave evidence to us a couple of weeks ago, Ian Ross stated that they would be prepared to apply Section 8s following an assessment, and he went on to say that legal action wouldn't stop them. Now, I have to say we heard them say that on the old RACI committee 3 years ago. Also, the Association of Deer Management Groups noted in written evidence to the committee that SNH has yet to use the statutory powers dating back to the Deer Act of 96 and the subsequent Land Reform Act, which you've already referred to in the previous question. Now, ADMG have said that they would have supported the use of these powers, but SNH has chosen not to use them. So can I ask Richard Cook in particular in what circumstances you or the ADMG group would support the use of Section 8 powers, and to the wider panel, can I ask why you think these powers have never been used?
Well, the system we have is a voluntary principle system of collaborative management. And in the great majority of cases, and I accept that it's still an unfolding story, in the great majority of cases, that collaborative approach is sufficient to deal with any problems that come up. But it has a backstop, and it has a very clear framework in terms of statute and guidance from government agencies. And where failure occurs, then I think we would not and have not opposed, have proposed the use of Section 8 by SNH to resolve a situation where you have an intractable conflict between the participants in a particular area. I have had conversations with SNH at staff level which have indicated a willingness to do that, but at some point there has been a lack of will to use the measures available. Now, I'm not saying we should rush out and look for a candidate and make an example of them, but there have been examples and will doubtless be future examples where there are problems that cannot be resolved without resort to statutory measures. So I think before SNH suggests that additional measures should be necessary, taking into account that there are some additional powers already granted to them this year in terms of the Land Reform Act, I think we need to see them use some of their existing powers where it is unavoidable. And I would commend SNH in the past for wanting to proceed by persuasion and encouragement and support, but there are circumstances, inevitably, in what is a very complex matter sometimes, and a very conflicted matter sometimes, there are circumstances where sometimes one has to use the statutory levers, and we have no objection in principle to that.
Okay, I think it's fair to say that there's frustration straight across the board with regard to the implementation of Section 8s. And you mentioned SNH officers who have said to you that that there was perhaps frustration on their part without wanting to put words in their mouths. But Ian Ross, when he was giving evidence here a few weeks ago, also said there was frustration at board level as well. So if there's all this frustration around, then why on earth is, if there's a need for a Section 8 wherever, why on earth is it not going ahead?
Members would go to the courts and challenge them if there was a Section 8 introduced on the grounds perhaps that they couldn't prove beyond reasonable doubt that the impacts were being caused purely by deer?
As I've said, deer tend to get blamed by default when something is not going right, and it is actually very difficult to say that that is deer and nothing else, or it is deer in combination with something else. So you're absolutely right to say that, convener. I mean, whether Section 8 would stand test in courts can only be proven by testing it in court. And if it's not effective, and I know that has been said, but I don't see why it shouldn't be, if it's not effective, then sufficient adjustment needs to be made to Section 8 so that it is effective. But at the moment, where caught in a situation where SNH do not feel confident in using a power that they've got. And we are prepared to say that in some circumstances we think use of the power may be justified.
Drew McFarlane, slide.
I think, Chairman, that it's also important that all stakeholders have confidence in the assessment process pertaining to upland habitats and the impacts of current land management practices. There is a document, a guide to upland habitats surveying land management impacts, which was produced in 1998, which is used as the Bible for these processes. But it's quite clear from the discussions that I've had with a number of our members that there is little confidence that that document is now fit for purpose. And indeed, a request was made to Andrew Thin when he was in charge of SNH to conduct a review of that document. Whether or not that is churning on and, within SNH at the moment, I'm not aware, but it is certainly an issue for us that that the current documents are not fit for purpose.
Okay. Thank you for that. Kate Forbes.
I'd like to ask your views on changes that should be made to deer management policy. Again, in written evidence, we've had various suggestions proposed, and the first is to do with SNH's powers. On one hand, the British Deer Society have suggested that there are currently a suite of powers which are adequate to manage any eventuality. And on the other hand, the Land Reform Review Group's proposals, which were then re-proposed in written evidence by the RSPB, suggested that SNH should be responsible for determining cull levels required and that landowners should have to apply to SNH with the number of deer that they plan to shoot so that SNH can determine if it's sufficient. What are the panel's views on these proposals?
As SNH said in this chamber 3 weeks ago, there is no magic number. So far as the Land Reform Review Group's recommendations are concerned about culls being set by SNH, I suggest that SNH would have the greatest difficulty finding the evidence that justified picking on a particular figure in a particular area for a particular purpose. It's difficult enough, as we've just heard, in terms of Section 7 areas. How much more difficult would it be in a deer management, in a complex deer management group situation? So I think fixing culls by mandate, which would in effect mean that we'd moved away from the voluntary principle, is not an option. And I would maintain that because SNH are very closely involved at field officer level with all the discussions about culls in deer management group areas, that they are, that their input is as much available under that situation, engaging with a particular deer management group, as it ever would be if they had to sit in Inverness and come up with a figure. So I think in practical terms, cull setting is fraught with difficulty. One aspect of the Land Reform Review Group's recommendations, which I would strongly agree with, is that perhaps the best proxy for deer populations and carrying capacity is the annual, is the cull, the national cull. And SNH have a power to require a return of cull to be made to them every year, and indeed they do that, but they only do that in respect of the holdings that they are aware of as being holdings where deer are culled. Now, as we've heard, deer are to be found on just about every hectare of Scotland, and there is no question, particularly in the lowlands, but to some extent in the highlands as well, that underreporting of the cull is a serious shortcoming. It would be really valuable if we could come up with a system where we could get a proper, accurate, reliable handle on the annual cull and take that as a measure of deer management success or failure, rather than the situation we're in at the moment. It has been tried by SNH. They did add a box to the Agricultural Holdings June return some years ago, where their farmers were asked to put in the number of deer culled in their holding, but it was made clear that it was voluntary because this was something to do with their human rights or something like that. So they couldn't require it, as they can require data to be returned on domestic livestock. That, not surprisingly, got a very low level of response and was dropped. Ironically, I think there is another possible way we could get at that, and that is through the new imposition of sporting rates on deer management, and I won't go into what I think the effect of that will be, because it will be mostly negative. But the regional assessors, as I've certainly sat beside them in this chamber in the past, have referred to if a full revaluation is carried out, which they're determined to do, and I know they have started the process, it will cover 55,000 holdings across Scotland as a whole. Now, that will be just about all the rural land in Scotland. That's the intention. When it was done pre-94, when the rating was suspended, it was only over 8,000 holdings. So what the assessor will have is a database that covers just about the whole of rural Scotland. Now, surely that could be a basis for a cull return that was an exhaustive assessment of what the annual cull is in Scotland, and that would be an enormously valuable piece of information. So that bit of the LRRG report, I firmly support.
I think it's hypocritical that environment groups are calling for more regulation when last July the John Muir Trust left 85 stags in July on the hillside when we've got food banks and starving kids. It's an absolute disgrace. I just wanted to make that point.
Because many of us would agree with that point that you've made, Mr. Hogg. That doesn't mean that the general point that's being made isn't valid, does it?
But, you know, there's no excuse to leave deer on the hill, 85 of them, to rot. No, none whatsoever. There's no argument there. It's an absolute disgrace.
Yes, but I return to the point I just made to you. Whilst many of us would agree with that point, it doesn't detract from the argument that's made by other environmental groups about the need for regulation. Right way or wrong way, they're entitled to make that point, and it may be justified. Does anybody else want to come in on this?
I think, Chairman, it is vitally important that we maintain the voluntary, collaborative, consensual approach that we're using just now to try and ensure that the deer managers across Scotland are fully participating in this process. I think if there were further regulation, as outlined by Kate Forbes in her question, it might act as a disincentive for some of our members. I think it is so important that we maintain this voluntary approach.
Mark Ruskell.
I understand your point of view on that, though, but isn't, you know, somebody has to make a judgment about what the cull rate has to be.
Yeah.
I mean, if your members' concerns is that they might be hit with a Section 7 and then eventually a Section 8, isn't RSPB's suggestion a way of actually passing responsibility to SNH? Then it's the responsibility then is on SNH to make the right decision based on the right data and ensure that that can be delivered using a full collaborative approach. So no longer becomes your responsibility, it's SNH's responsibility.
I absolutely understand the point that you're making, but that then, I mean, why then do we need deer management groups? Why don't we just let the SNH deal with us themselves?
To carry out the actions on the ground.
But why would our members want to participate in that? In this process, we have members who are carrying out functions on their own land to create economic activity, to create jobs, to provide services in remote rural areas. If the government impose their own strategies on this, I think it will disincentivise those private owners from the business that they're involved in.
I wouldn't necessarily shut down the business. I mean, it just might mean you end up with deer with bigger carcass weights.
Richard Cook.
Deer management groups, and you'll say again, you would say this, wouldn't you? Deer management groups are now being suggested as a model for collaborative management on a much broader basis. I mean, landscape scale management is what we're all thinking about now, and considering the big picture rather than the minute picture of local management at site level. And deer management groups are a good model for that because they engage all the players. And I would like to think that we can expand, as is already happening, our range of responsibilities in terms of deer management to other types of management. I've said on a number of occasions this morning, when we make decisions about deer management, they need to be with full awareness and consciousness of all the other factors at play. And the same will apply to sheep management or reforestation or any other type of land use change. So the voluntary principle is a precious thing. That particular suggestion taken from the Land Reform Review Group proposal is in effect statutory management. It transfers the responsibility for management for deer from the private individual to the state. Now, there are cost implications there, and I've already referred to the costs in the report. Now, there would have to be some discussion as to how that would be funded, because the participation, and this is not meant to suggest any sort of a threat, the participation would be at the very least seriously demotivated by undermining of the growing, increasingly successful voluntary principle mechanism we've got. And I would remind you that the voluntary principle is very much curtailed in its wriggle room. It's not a free-for-all. We have a government, we have a statute, three acts that have a bearing on deer management. We have a policy document that covers 3 years. We have the code of practice for deer management. We have ADMG's own benchmark. We have the tools that tell you how to do the job. And now we have the assessment process. I would suggest that there is more scrutiny and regulation and assessment of the public interest applied to deer management than any other land use in Scotland. The equivalent, as applied to arable farming, would be for farmers to have to submit their cropping plan on an annual basis to community councils. I mean, and we welcome that. It's fine. We're prepared to operate under the microscope. We are prepared to respond to the challenge that was put to us in 2014 to be more transparent. There are 33 deer management plans online as we speak, and that is increasing all the time. They're there to be seen. We're okay with that. But the vital spark is the individual involvement, the individual responsibility of the participants in deer management groups, and it would be a great shame to lose that.
The deputy convener is going to wrap this session up with a final question.
Yes, thank you, panel. We're nearly there. In terms of conclusions, the report makes no recommendations. Rather, it conducts evaluations and then a number of conclusions thereafter. In light of this, what proposals or recommendations would you like to make? And as a supplementary within that, do you think SNH is sufficiently resourced to enhance deer management in Scotland?
Richard Cook.
Last word for me anyway. Recommendations, and I would say this, wouldn't I? The recommendations is that we've done some very good work in the last 2 years. As you've heard from a number of people, seeing that in terms of environmental change is a longer term prospect. But let's not forget that it's also about social and economic benefits. The quantum leap we've made needs time to work. We accept that we'll be back in front of this committee in 3 years' time. Hopefully, well, I'm confident that we will have more to show for it at that stage. We are only at the beginning of the design period. Now we've got to go and deliver it. We can do that. So far as SNH's role is concerned, we have, over a very long period, worked very closely with SNH and its predecessor body, DCS. That will continue, certainly from our point of view. The engagement at ground level has been particularly valuable, although the recent restructuring of the SNH wildlife staff has, I'm afraid, not been terribly helpful, and I'm not sure that they have been involved in the scrutiny of this report. But we will work with them. As I say, the picture I want to paint is of a sector that is moving rapidly forward, and I'm going to tell you that that's what's going to continue.
What do you mean by the wildlife staff might not have been involved in scrutiny of this report?
When we were presented with the report, which was on the day when it was announced, we were advised that the next job of those who were presenting it to us was to go and announce it to their own staff. It had been kept, for whatever reasons, it had been kept entirely within the compiling team and at board level. So the next job was to explain it to the wildlife staff. I suspect that some of the anomalies that we've heard this morning in terms of the mismatches between DMG densities and the extrapolated densities of JHI would have been picked up by the wildlife management officers and said, this just does not make sense. We need to have another look.
Okay. So can I just raise another point, Mr. Cook? There's some suggestion that a couple of work streams have now had to be funded by the DMGs. Could you clarify that? Because we had an answer from SNH that kind of left it out there a little bit 3 weeks ago.
There is no doubt that the reduction in funding to SNH has had an effect on what they can deliver. We know that they are not, when they lose staff, they are not replacing them. We know that their wildlife team have been dispersed around the areas, which possibly for reasons of efficiency, but it has reduced the their strength in working together. We also know that some of the really important tools that we need to do our job, and I'm thinking of wild deer best practice, which has been allowed to wither on the vine, and also SWORD, which is a really important data processing system, which we must have, are no longer sufficiently funded by SNH to go forward. We have been told that SNH will support us as best they can with that. So ADMG is raising funds privately. We're currently at a figure of rather over £40,000 and need it to be half as much again to do this. So that we're prepared to put money to this because we just need it to do what we're being expected to do. So in answer to Maurice Golden's question, I would say SNH need more funds if they are going to deliver what is clearly in the public interest in terms of deer management.
Okay. Drew McFarlane, sorry.
Chairman, I mean, what I would like to say is that from the point of view of Scottish Land and Estates, we'd like to underline the point that many deer managers in Scotland will really feel disappointed and disheartened by the SNP report, particularly...
The SNH report.
SNH.
Sorry about that.
Chairman, it's a natural comedian in me that put that out. I do apologise. The SNH report has put me off my stride as well. That report has done nothing to help deer managers in Scotland carry on with their work in the way they've been doing it. It is discouraging, it is disincentivising us. What I would like to see is SNH properly funded to assist us, because I will underline the fact that within the Mona Leas, the SNH have been a great partner for us. They have been very supportive, have been helpful in as delivering our outputs. I cannot fault them for that. But this report does not generate the kind of partnership that we think that we've developed locally.
Okay. Alec Hogg.
Just really quickly, the Scottish public voted the red deer as number one iconic species. And if you look at the employees in SNH, there's 500 of them, but there's only 12 dealing with deer. So they would desperately need help on that deer side. They're underrepresented. Thank you.
Thank you for those points. I think we'll wrap this session up now. Thank you very much for your time, gentlemen. That was a useful session for us. I'm going to suspend very briefly till we change the panel over. We welcome back. We now continue the session on deer management in Scotland. We're joined by a second panel comprising Mike Daniels of the John Muir Trust, Maggie Keenan of the Scottish Wildlife Trust, Grant Moyer of Cairngorms National Park Authority, Duncan Orr Ewing, the convener of the Deer Subgroup for Scottish Environment Link, and Simon Pepper of the Forest Policy Group. I would say that if you don't feel the need to answer any particular question, then don't feel the need to do that, but please do contribute where you feel it's appropriate. You were, I think, all sat in the audience for the last couple of hours and you heard the comments from the deer management groups and others. They are quite clear that there are some significant errors in the report. I'd welcome your thoughts on that. Duncan Orr Ewing.
Well, we think the report is a fair one. All SNH are doing is bringing together all of the evidence around deer management in one place for the first time. Which is very helpful. To be frank, you know, the evidence around this subject is never going to be perfect, and I think the debate that went beforehand kind of indicated that. But SNH have used all the available data. The conclusions, they've made it clear that the conclusions of the report are based around the hard data, not the interpretation that was described by Mark Ruskill earlier. I mean, frankly, some of the discussions we've just had around whether the data is precisely accurate, whether the population of deer or the density of deer is 12 or whether it's 15%, is slightly arbitrary. I mean, the fact is the deer densities are still too high to deliver the public interest. And we know that in other countries, for example, deer density is around 0.5 per hectare, per kilometre square, rather than the 12 to 15 we've been talking about. So, you know, I think SNH have also ensured that this report has had independent scientific scrutiny. In the forward to the document at the bottom paragraph, it highlights who has been involved in the collation of this data and how it has been scrutinised.
But there do appear to be some factual errors in the report. Doesn't that undermine it, Maggie Keenan?
Looking at the evidence, we spoke to SNH about this, and they assured us that the graph on page, the figure on page 20 is robust. They did say that the modelling by James Hutton Institute was modelling, and that in no way actually is how they draw the conclusions or the evidence of the report. And actually, the same as what's been said before, it's the impacts that important, and also the pace of change. And for me, one of the most important things in the document is the figures on page 68 to 71, which paint the actual picture of how deer management groups are addressing some of the public interest issues which deliver the Scottish biodiversity strategy. And as you've already queried with the first group, you know, while some are doing very well and made good progress, a lot haven't made the progress and the required changes that will be necessary to actually deliver the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy.
Okay. Simon Pepper.
I think I'd like to make the point that whilst there may be some dispute about details, the overall thrust of the report is very robust. I think suggestions that it was prepared with bias or with bad faith are very unfortunate. SNH has no motivation to exercise bias in this at all. Indeed, I can't speak for SNH, but I'm pretty sure they would be the first to celebrate if there was genuine evidence in here that we were going to be meeting targets on time. The question was, has there been adequate progress and is it going to meet targets? The answer to that in the report is quite clear. The sector is praised for the progress that it's making. But you can hear from the evidence that you've just heard. They're saying that they haven't had time yet to demonstrate delivery of the results. So it's hardly surprising that SNH lacks confidence that those results will be delivered on time. So the question really is whether they have the opportunity to deliver those objectives on time. They've expressed fulsomely their intention to do so, and it seems to us that they should be given that chance, but that we should also be preparing for the possibility that some of them may not, and to ask ourselves whether the arrangements are in place to make quite sure that those things are delivered if there still turns out to be difficulty in some cases.
Okay. Grant Moyle.
From our point of view, the information about the Cairngorms National Park appears to be relatively accurate in terms of our understanding of what's happening within the Cairngorms. So from that point of view, I can say that the report reads well from that.
Mm-hmm. In terms of its validity, isn't the fact that it's so critical, one might see it as a condemnation of SNH's oversight of deer management as much as the DMG. So the fact it's presented in that way should give us confidence that it's accurate. Would you accept that point? Maggie Keenan.
Yes, I think, I mean, we heard from, I was sat here listening to SNH giving evidence, and I think there's no doubt that they've tried to bend over backwards to deliver, the policy, which is the voluntary approach. And you could argue that in some cases they've given it too long to work, particularly when we're talking about the Section 8 agreement, when actually it says in the Act under Section 8 that one could be enacted after 6 months. We've had discussions amongst ourselves about this, and one of the feelings that we have is that SNH are asked to be, regulators and enforcers, like a role that SEPA have, so they're having to switch from being advisors and always looking for conciliation and stuff, and it just may not come as naturally to them as to others. So maybe one of the recommendations at the end is that they have to be, much more robust and really be backed by government to deliver the policies that everybody wants them to deliver.
Okay, let's move this on. Emma Harper.
In a letter to the committee dated on the 5th of December, the SNH provided information about three research projects. Two are due at the end of January 17 and one at the end of March. So that's Wild Deer Research Support and Strathcoley, I think. I'm just wondering if you think that the SNH and the stakeholders have the accurate data and research available to them in order to make robust evidence-based policy.
Do you mean in terms of what they've said in the report, the conclusions in the report?
Bearing in mind that there's additional reports due at the end of January.
Yeah, well, as I say, the densities and the populations, and there may be some dispute, but as everybody's saying, is what we need to do is look at impacts. And how, if we're talking about red deer, how deer management groups are working in practice. And there's no doubt that some are working very well, but there's no doubt that some are not addressing the public interest. And so SNH has scrutinised the 44 deer management plans and assessed them against the public interest criteria. And quite a lot of them haven't come up to the mark. So their conclusions are based on how well the deer management plans are going to deliver the public interest, because that was the whole point of the report. And because they're finding that most of them aren't going to deliver it, that's why they come up with the conclusions that they're not certain that there's been the step change necessary that they need to see.
Okay. Are any of you surprised, as I certainly am, that given that the committees of this Parliament have taken a very serious interest in deer management for the past 3 years, and that SNH knew that this review was to be conducted at the end of 2016, they hadn't commissioned and delivered the piece of work on the estimated count of red deer on the hill ground by now? Or perhaps not. Duncan or Ewing?
No, I mean, just to say, I mean, all of this data is helpful and informs deer management best practice. I mean, it will certainly be helpful to have more information on localised deer densities. I mean, some of these projects take time to act, but I think the point is that over the piece, SNH have generally, and I think Maggie used the term, bent over backwards to try and give the voluntary approach to deer management its best chance. They've invested heavily in research. to help inform that process. They've also invested heavily, actually, in the production of deer management plans. Mm-hmm. I mean, that cost 160K, I think the report says. We're also investing in a whole range. I mean, the Forestry Commission as well have invested here as well. Mm-hmm. So, you know, wild deer are natural. In terms of timescales, I mean, wild deer, a national approach was published in 2008, and that set out quite clearly the public interest tests that needed to be met. So, you know, in terms of the timescales, we're not just actually talking about since the RACI committee considered the evidence in 2013. We had the Deer Code in 2012, of course, which set out the public interest criteria as well. So I think, you know, in terms of the full package, and SNH, I should also say, SNH have also provided a huge amount of information behind the scenes to the deer management groups to help them produce the deer management plans. So behind the scenes, SNH really have bent over backwards to try and make the voluntary approach work. And I think what, you know, I'm coming to the conclusion that the voluntary approach just simply isn't adequate, and SNH needs support from government to use the powers that they've got and to deliver a more functional deer management system.
Simon Pepper, the policy group have actually touched on that in their submission about SNH not being sufficiently well backed by government to deliver on this. What specifically do you mean by that?
Only that I think its reluctance to move from voluntary to compulsory, and as Richard Cook very rightly said, it may seem a paradox, but a compulsory backstop measure is an essential part of a voluntary system. Mm-hmm. Their reluctance to move beyond the voluntary to use the compulsory powers where it might seem appropriate, there are all sorts of reasons why I think that's happened, and one of them is the what Ian Ross in his evidence before you a couple of weeks ago referred to as the policy position, which was, I think, his rather cryptic way of referring to the extent to which he feels supported by ministers. And certainly I feel that stronger, clearer support now from the relatively new cabinet secretary, indicating a much clearer government resolve behind SNH's powers in this would be very helpful indeed.
Existing powers and the powers that were delivered by the Land Reform Act?
Both.
Both?
Yeah.
Okay. Right, okay. Emma Harper, do you have another question?
Yeah, it's about lowland deer management, and I'm aware lowland deer management isn't just about the south of Scotland. In evidence to the committee, the Lowland Deer Network stated that it may lie in farmers and landowners taking more responsibility, either individually or collectively, for sustainable management. What barriers do you think are faced by farmers and landowners in the lowlands which might prevent them taking responsibility for sustainable deer management?
Could I respond to that by saying that I think Mr. Playfair made some very good points about the situation in the lowlands. And by the way, the distinction between lowlands and the hill ground is not as clear as sometimes is suggested, that red deer are dealt with by the deer management groups and all deer on ground below the sporting estates is dealt with by others. There's very large parts of Scotland, I think it's 61% altogether of Scotland, is not covered by a deer management group. And they cover everything from the fringes of the sporting estates right down to the centre of cities. Mm-hmm. The conspicuous absence, it seems to us, in terms of the what is available to those trying to manage deer in those circumstances is a lack of data. The deer management groups have accepted and demonstrated the need for collective data shared between all the participants so that everybody knows what's going on. That data is not available to people outside the deer management groups. In general, there are a few exceptions. But generally, those who are trying to or should be persuaded to manage deer responsibly in what are called the lowlands very broadly need to know what's going on in their area. If you have, especially if it's a small area of land and you have some responsibilities or you are affected by deer, you need to know what your neighbour's doing. You need to have the data as to how many deer there are and in particular to know how many your neighbour is planning to cull in the next while, so that you can relate that to the impacts that you're experiencing. And that discussion just isn't happening in very large parts of what are broadly referred to as the lowlands. So our suggestion would be that one serious improvement that could be made to encourage the use of the voluntary principle would be to equip anybody who's interested with easily accessible, it can be done digitally, easily accessible, up-to-date information about the status of deer in the area and who is culling what and who is planning to cull what. And you could add to that, as time went on, add to the database information about impacts, public interest impacts, and indeed private interest impacts, that should build a picture which informs a local discussion. Then you'll get responsible people acting responsibility, because they're able to access up-to-date information that they need.
Would that have the effect of getting more local authorities to exercise their responsibilities in this area as well?
I think it would be, I'd say it's an absolute fundamental. Without this information, nobody knows what they're doing. Everybody's acting with a blindfold. So as soon as you expose this information and allow a discussion, a debate to evolve in the local area, in the context of what the public interests are in the local mm-hmm. area, whether it's to do with deer vehicle collisions or damage to gardens or farms or forests or anything, wildlife issues, natural heritage issues. Unless you've got the information, you don't have any basis on which to make rational decisions.
Okay, thank you. Mark Roscoe.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, if I could return back to the issue of deer densities again. Do you have any thoughts on, you know, what that magic number is for deer density? I mean, what I think I heard from the previous panel is that it's very difficult to pin that down. Every estate, every circumstance is unique, with unique habitats around it, unique conditions. So is it possible to kind of generalise in terms of policy around deer density?
I think in your question, you put your finger on it. The answer is no, you can't generalise. And it's folly to generalise. What does need to happen is that in every local area, the facts need to be taken into account. The balance between private interests and the public interests need to be assessed. They need to be assessed fairly in a way that is accountable locally, and decisions drawn. Of course, there's a national component in there, but the decision about what is the appropriate number per square kilometre to have in an area varies enormously across Scotland, and to suggest that there is a magic number is quite wrong.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's probably one of the most interesting questions. I mean, we've just had the National Park Partnership Plan consultation, which asked that roughly those questions, which was around, should the partnership plan set guidance on the appropriate range of deer densities necessary to deliver the public interest? And we had a lot of interest from people, as you can imagine, in that, and a lot of polarised views on that as well. But the bit that I think is quite interesting is the public interest part. And I think one of the things that certainly we are keen on in the park and through the park partnership plan is to set out more clearly what that public interest is. So spatially, can you say, well, if you're looking at woodland expansion in these places, if you're looking at peatland restoration in these places, if you're looking at getting designated sites back into favourable condition, what does that mean you need to do in terms of not just deer, other things as well? And do you do that through deer culling? Do you do that through fencing? Do you do it through that other mechanisms that are available to people? But you need to set out clearly what that public interest is spatially to be able to have that conversation. I think that's pretty crucial. And I think there's a link back to the land use strategy and the side of things that was said about rural land use partnerships and the potential for plans being part of that. And if you look at what's happening in both national parks, the park partnership plan is in effect that rural land use strategy for those areas. So if you can have that conversation about what the public interest is, add in the private interest in terms of what people are wanting to do with their individual estates, then you can have a conversation about what are the appropriate deer densities associated with that. And I think that's the really clear bit that needs to happen. If there is not agreement then between that, there's the question of what's the backstop, and I think that's a fair enough question in terms of is that into Section 7, Section 8, or is that a different mechanism? But I think actually having more clarity on the public interest and how that is set out, and actually being able to have that conversation more realistic and actually where people can get involved in it, I think would make a big difference.
Mm-hmm. Can we get some
to get the on the record the point about peatland restoration, Mr. Moya, because I visited a potential project in Invermark in the National Park where they were talking about what was quite an exciting project of peatland restoration, and then we had to consider, having restored the peatland, we would need to put a fence around it to protect that restoration. So, you know, deer impacts are quite significant across kind of a range of issues. Mike Daniel, sorry.
I think to answer Mark's question, I think densities are key to some way, because if you look at the public interest, if you look at SNH-owned land, you look at Forest Commission-owned land, you look at NGO-owned land, you know, what are the densities there compared with what the density in a sporting estate is? And generally, the densities are much lower, and nobody really needs a density higher than, you know, 4 or 5, apart from the sporting interest, I would argue. And also, if you compare the densities across Europe, as was mentioned earlier, you know, they are 0.1 to 0.5. So I think there's a kind of 10 times difference here we have in our highest density areas. So I take Simon's point that you need to know what your objectives are, but I think a way of, as Grant says, a way of actually working out what your objective is, you then need to turn that into a number and work out what the density should be, really.
Okay, Maggie.
I just want to add a point about the land use strategy. Wholeheartedly support that. That would help, as well as ecosystem health indicators. But interestingly, reading Duncan Halley's his report, in Norway, they set cull targets as well based on the deer weights. And if the deer weights are going down, and I think the carrying capacity of the land cannot support them, then they increase the cull, and it's dependent on, you know, so there's quite a lot of factors, so they're taking in the deer welfare as well.
And are you?
Just to expand on this a bit, because a number of our organisations also have practical experience of reducing deer numbers on the land that we manage, you know, to allow the habitat to recover. And actually, once the habitat is covered, you can then let the deer densities go back up again. But the critical point is you need to take the step in the first place to actually reduce the deer numbers to give the habitat time. And we do know that a number of the habitats that are most seriously impacted by deer, particularly uplands, peatlands and woodlands, do take time to recover. And just in terms of the spatial mapping point, I agree with what's been said previously, but for some habitats, for example, peatlands, we now have good spatial mapping of the peatland resource in Scotland. And I think I've read that the deer densities that you need to allow peatlands to recover is around 0.4 deer per hectare. Or square kilometre.
Okay.
Objectives are at the outset, including the economic objectives, presumably as well, around sporting estates, but putting that in the mix.
Thank you. Good morning to the second. Good afternoon to the second panel. I want to drill down, please, with all of you who feel it's appropriate to answer, in relation to whether the environmental impacts that we're discussing today. To the extent to which they are due to deer, and I've just noted what you said, Duncan or Ewing, about deer numbers and evidence. It would be useful if you were able to send us some of that information that you just referred to previously, because that would be an interesting factor for the committee to consider. I think you've all heard about the 2020 challenge to Scotland's biodiversity targets, and I'm not going to go into the detail of that again because it was highlighted during the first session. But the SNH report states on page 33, and I quote, of the 1,606 features examined, 56 of the features have a negative overgrazing pressure identified, compared with only 9% having negative undergrazing pressures. So it would seem from that report that deer populations are the main factor leading to insufficient progress in native woodland planting restoration. Now, there's been dispute of that, and I would like to know what the panel thinks about that, and more broadly about whether it is deer or other herbivores. It's very hard to generalise these things, but any comments would be valued.
Well, I went back and looked at the Scotland's Native Woodland Survey, because obviously it can be, you know, mixed results. It could be sheep, it could be deer. But one of the things it did say was that deer were recorded as a significant presence in 73% of native woodlands, livestock 15%, rabbits and hares just 3.5%. And then in the conclusions of the report, it says deer are the most widespread type of herbivore and are likely to be the major source of impacts. So I don't have my own evidence, but I'm going on a Scottish Government long-term report.
Sorry, what was the date of that report?
It was the native woodland. Unfortunately, it wasn't out when we were giving evidence in 2013.
Right.
So it came out. And so it's actually been quoted in here, but they didn't go into all of the details, which I think would have been a bit more helpful.
All right, thank you.
Anyone else? Grant Moyle.
In terms of the park, I mean, the Kingdom's National Park is 49% Natura and 25% SSSI, which is the highest in Scotland by quite a distance. But overgrazing remains the most significant pressure affecting designated features in the park, and it's affecting 126 features ahead of disturbance and burning. And I suppose it depends on where you are in the park as to where that is significantly deer or where that is, in some parts, sheep grazing. So I think it does get down to fairly local circumstances, that rather than general, you can generalise across the national park to say it's all deer, it's all sheep, or it's a mixture of two. In certain places it'll be one, in certain places the other, in certain places it'll be a mixture of the two. So, but it is, overgrazing is still the main reason why 19% of features are still not favourable or recovering. So that's.
Okay. Duncan, over
you. I'm picking up from the SNH report that 50% of the deer management groups fail to identify actions in deer management plans to actually deal with deer impacts in designated sites, which suggests a failure of the current process. I mean, SNH have provided that information up front, but still it's not being dealt with.
Simon Pepper.
The distinction between sheep and deer, or for that matter, other herbivores and deer, is much easier to make in the lowlands. In the lowlands, most livestock is enclosed for livestock, and so damage that you experience in a woodland if it's been caused by deer, it's very clear that it's only deer. And if you ask anybody trying to grow trees anywhere below the head dike, anywhere in Scotland, they'll tell you that a major constraint and a major cost, often a prohibitive extra cost because it isn't supported by subsidy, is fencing.
Okay. Jenny Goldruth.
Just a supplementary on that. Dr. Keegan, we spoke previously to the previous panel about the impact of the deer management group sector in terms of challenging the tree planting target, I suppose, in terms of their role. And there was a reluctance from that panel to perhaps accept that deer were to blame, as it were. We spoke as well about sheep and the impact they might have in terms of reaching that planting target. Would you agree then with the Forest Policy Group, who argue that they need to challenge specifically on this point?
Well, I don't think you can argue with the conclusions of the Native Woodland Survey report. Mm-hmm. And actually, when we had a conversation with SNH following their evidence, and we asked them specifically, can you tell the difference in terms of herbivore impact, if you do a herbivore impact assessment between deer and sheep so that you can work out what the problem is? And they said that they could. They had confidence that they could. So, you know, in some circumstances that there could be a combination of both, but if you know what the primary cause is, then that's the one you should be addressing. Mm-hmm. Does that answer your question, or do you? Mm-hmm. Is that okay?
Okay. Mike Daniels, do you want to come in?
The previous one as well. I think, I mean, there's a general, to answer your question generally, if you look out a window in Scotland, you can only grow trees behind a deer fence. And in lots of other countries in Europe, natural regeneration is the most common way of woodland to grow. So, I mean, on the other side, is that deer are actually a natural part of the woodland. We don't want to fence deer out of all the woodlands. Deer are should be there, but at a much lower density. And I think in the report, it was interesting, there was SNH report, there was some mention of 3,000 kilometres of deer fencing that's about to deteriorate in the next few years, which I think, using some analogies, like, you know, 20 times the Scottish border. So, I mean, in terms of the cost of options going forward to renew that fence in the public, this is public sector fencing, 3,000 kilometres over the next 20 years, there's going to be a huge cost, as opposed to having a lower deer number, not no deer, but having a much lower deer number. So I think that, and the reason that is deer fencing is because of, obviously for woodland, is because it's deer that's the main issue they're trying to keep out.
Okay. Alexander Burnett.
Thank you very much. A question for Grant Moore. Obviously, a
glad you raised the National Park, which we share a bit with a constituency which I represent. We talked earlier about Section 7s that had been in place and why some hadn't been lifted. I understand in Mar Lodge, which is in our, both our areas, that the Section 7 there was due to be lifted at the end of last year, subject to satisfactory habitat reports. You know, those reports have come through and are satisfactory. And the deer population has, you know, evidence been reduced in the woodland areas, woodland zones. Can I just ask what his view is on, what your view is on why that Section 7 hasn't been lifted, and what do you think its plans might be in the future?
I think there are actually a number of people who find the Section 7 grouping quite a useful grouping, actually, in terms of discussing some of those issues. So it's not just a question of the actual formal mechanism of the Section 7. Actually, because there's quite a lot of issues in that area, it's actually quite a useful grouping to bring those folk together. It is also, and Mar Lodge is one of the issues that I would have brought up anyway, is the boundary issues between deer management groups. And obviously Mar Lodge sits at the edge of one deer management group abutting two other deer management groups, so we've got quite different deer management regimes. So in terms of why it hasn't been brought to conclusion, I don't have an answer to you on that. I would need to go back and check on that, so I can't speculate on that. But in terms of the people involved in it, I know they find the grouping quite useful in terms of discussing those deer management issues within that area. But I do think that boundary issues are one that is worth thinking about as well, in terms of how deer management groups work with each other across boundary, because some of the big issues are actually between deer management groups, not within deer management groups. And that's especially true in the Cairngorms, where there's quite different objectives within different deer management groups.
Dave Stewart, I think you're going to come to the line of question that maybe chimes with Mike Daniel's last point.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I'm quite interested, as you depicted that from the previous session, about costs and benefits that have to be made in decision-making. And if I can just quote the key finding 7 from SNH, they said, and I'm quoting, "The management of deer in Scotland results in a net monetary loss for both the private and public sectors. However, many of the impacts and benefits are not easy to assess or do not lend themselves to monetary valuation." What is your assessment? Maggie Keegan?
Well, I could put it in terms of, say, natural capital. So if we think of some of the opportunities that are not being taken in some areas because of the impact of deer, so I could list a few. I mean, I was very struck by how deer are managed in Norway, in southwest Norway, and how the opportunities that come to communities living there because of the lower deer numbers and the fact that they have some woodland regeneration. I'm not suggesting that happens everywhere, but in terms of, say, carbon sequestration, timber production, wood fuel, woodlands used for foraging, berries and fungi, education, recreational opportunities, biodiversity, natural flood management in terms of riparian habitats, and in terms, you know, there's quite a lot of things in there that would be very difficult to quantify, but they are actual benefits. And so I don't think that was totally captured in the report, but it's difficult to put a value on those things. Although we know biodiversity in Scotland, the ecosystem services worth about $21 billion to Scotland every year.
So in some senses there's hidden costs but also hidden benefits as well.
Yes, I'm sure there is.
I mean, I think the socioeconomic one is a question that really needs to be tackled more. So, I mean, I think there's undoubtedly all the deer stalkers, both in the private sector and the NGO sector and the state sector, and you know, it's a really hard job. They're out there day and night, hard work, and I think that needs to be really acknowledged. But at lower deer densities, we're actually arguing you need more people employed, you need far more employment, and it's much harder to cull deer when there's less of them. So, I mean, I remember Richard Cook once in a long time ago in a meeting standing up and saying that, you know, no estate owner made money from running a deer estate. And I think it is true to say that you don't own a sporting estate to make money. You own a sporting estate because you have money. And I think it's not a model that generates economic return, but there is economic activity and there's social benefit of employing staff to do that job. And I think it's a misconception to say that if you have an environmental situation, you know, as a priority where you reduce deer numbers, that you don't employ people. All the NGOs here represented who cull deer, you know, employ people to do that, and we employ in some cases more than we were previously employed. So there's a different type of employment, and there's certainly still an absolute place for traditional deer management, but it's just trying to get a sense where you have a much lower deer density and a healthier environment. I think that would have all these other benefits economic benefits that come from flood protection, that come from peatland restoration, woodland regeneration, you know, a whole range of benefits that we just, because we're looking at bare hills and we don't see them, we don't know they're there, but they will come and they will benefit the country as a whole, not just the landowners that happen to manage the land at this time.
Grant Moyle.
I think this is actually a really crucial question, which is around the employment side of things, because it is something that is one of the main discussions with the states around that, is in terms of the amount of people who are employed in this sector, and it provides employment in remote areas, and you know that's something that we're keen to try and retain, is try and keep people in remote areas working on the land, etc. Is this the only way to do it? And what is the opportunity cost of doing it in the current model? And if you wanted to move to a different model, what would that be? And I think that's actually really difficult for people to get their heads around in terms of some of this stuff. But I suppose one of the things you can do is if you point at a number of states where there has been a significant reduction in deer numbers, there hasn't been a significant reduction in employment. So that's something that's, you know, it's not just a case of, you know, there's been a reduction in deer numbers, there's thus been a reduction in employment. Actually, that doesn't stack up when you look at some of the estates that have done that around Scotland. So I think it's worth looking at the evidence on that in terms of what has happened on these estates where there's been a reduction in deer numbers, because it's not a simple, you know, ratio between one and the other.
Be one of the gaps in the evidence that we have to consider at the moment. Simon Pepple.
Just to add to what has been said, I would agree that it's very difficult to know what to make of the economic appraisal in the report, especially when included in it is an assessment of the value of deer. But nobody's suggesting that deer should not be there. The question is how many, and the argument that there will be fewer benefits arising if there are fewer deer doesn't really stack up, I don't think. If you send people down the road when you've reduced your deer, the first thing that will happen is deer numbers will increase again. So it is going to be an ongoing, continuous requirement for a workforce, and a very skilled, active workforce it is too, that it should continue to have employment. But the question perhaps goes back, though, to the vision that it's bought by everybody concerned, the so-called WDNA, the Wild Deer National Approach document, which talks about a vision of achieving the best combination of benefits to all, and that's where these arguments come into play. Where's the best combination of benefits to all? And to look at the land reform agenda, which is about securing the benefit of land for the many, not the few. It's about more engagement by community. It's about revitalization of the rural economy. And there's a strong argument to suggest that the particular preference for high deer numbers currently being imposed by a sector is not necessarily in the best benefit of all, which is the direction of policy, I think.
And I think just for the record as well, that the community empowerment legislation has a role to play here as well. My final question, convener, is again, if I can just quote evidence to the Committee for Marriage PB, who've said, in our view, there needs to be a rebalancing of the deer culling effort between the public and private sectors to ensure the private sector increases its efforts. How would you respond?
Although under the link...
His day job.
Yeah. I mean, at the moment, the facts are that the Forestry Commission actually take a third of the national deer cull each year, and they've managed to drive down deer densities, as is said in the report, on the National Forest Estate, on 9% of the land. So actually, that is an additional cost currently to the public. So, you know, at the moment, I think the chart on page, is it page 20 of the report, and the text around that suggests that the current levels of deer cull elsewhere, but also probably including the forestry data, are not sufficient to reduce the current population of deer. So, you know, I'm reading into that we need more effort from the private sector and perhaps more engagement by others in the way that Simon has just described, to help with that effort. We need more people culling deer and reducing deer, not the same number that we currently have.
Right, thank you. Moving on, in 2013, the then RACI committee was told that it was too early to come to judgment on the impact of the Code of Practice, which was introduced in 2011 as part of the Wayne Act. Now we're told it's too early to come to judgment on the impact of deer management plans. How long do we have to wait to see a genuine return on this? Maggie Keegan.
Yes, convener. I was just sat there thinking, I'm in 2013. But I think an important point to note, which everybody recognises, is actually the habitats take a long time to recover. And so there should be some urgency about not waiting. And that would be the point, actually. If we're given another 3 years, then, or 4 years, or 5 years, then the habitats continue to deteriorate. And we haven't got that time to wait in terms of delivering the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy.
OK, so let's broaden this out a little bit as you answer that point. What do we need to do to build some momentum into this? Duncan or Ewing?
Well, we've suggested, as was mentioned by Kate Forbes earlier, that we need some, I mentioned we need some rebalancing as well. I think, you know, what we're suggesting is more emphasis needs to be put on the individual here in terms of deer culling. At the moment, we have a deer management group structure, but those that are not, you know, following best practice, meeting the public interest, are able to hide under those structures. So, I mean, the Land Reform Review Group report did make some sensible suggestions about socially responsible cull levels. Slightly different, Richard Cook mentioned that he didn't agree with the onus being put on the deer management groups by SNH, largely because he wanted the voluntary approach to continue. I think he's misread slightly what the Land Reform Review Group report is saying in that context. My reading of it is what is suggested is that individual landowners should come up with a proposition about what a socially responsible deer population should look like on their land. Then they should submit that to SNH, who will either say yes or no if they don't feel it is adequate. And maybe they would pick particular geographical areas where they think there is a particular problem, so a blanket approach wouldn't be adopted. And I think that was the approach that the Land Reform Review Group was suggesting, which, to my reading, still gives the voluntary approach traction to a large extent in that process.
I saw Simon Pepper nodding his head in agreement there.
Yes, I think it's well worth dwelling, if we may, briefly on the Land Reform Review Group recommendations, because I think they were significantly misunderstood or misrepresented earlier. I don't mean maliciously, I mean just unfortunately misrepresented. I've looked in this in great detail because it seemed to me when you look at the detail of what the... It wasn't particularly well expressed. I have to give them that. But when you look at the detail of the recommendations, there's a lot in there which is very well worth pursuing as grounds for improvement of the way that the voluntary principle might work. A key element that gets misunderstood is the use of the word determining, that SNH should determine a cull in any particular area. And I've looked into this in great detail, and it's quite clear in the rest of what they say that they don't mean preemptively decide and impose top-down. What they mean is that SNH should scrutinise and approve, with the option then to, as Duncan is saying, either let the plans proceed or go back to the owner and say, sorry, our perception of the public interest here is that you need to be culling more. A dialogue starts, and if the case is put properly and courteously, you'd expect a responsible owner to accept the case that's being put, that they need to cull more, and you'd expect to see behaviours change. And there's a very courteous and sensible and low-key approach embodied in that proposal, which I think deserves a great deal of further consideration.
Perhaps so, but what would the backstop be?
Well, that's the next key thing. So what is required in order to
start that conversation is the data that I was talking about before. And then there's this process of approving, and perhaps it could evolve into a consent. I think that's the term that's used by the Land Reform Review Group. But then the question really, and this is the fundamental key to an effective system, the question is there a credible backup power? At present, you know, with the best will in the world, given all of the difficulties that have been experienced, I don't think anybody would say that we have a credible backup power in place. It hasn't been used, for, as we've discussed before, for a variety of reasons, but nobody has any faith in it. So we need to be looking at perhaps slight adjustments to the legislation which enable a swifter, more straightforward, entirely accountable and appealable, of course, measure that allows SNH, when the dialogue has come to a halt and no progress is being made, perhaps because the owner is not willing or not able or simply refuses to do what's asked of them, a measure to ensure that the required coal to deliver the public interest is actually delivered.
Duncan, how are you?
Convener, I think you mentioned earlier that, you know, Section 7s are not a new thing. They came in when the DCS was managing deer issues in Scotland. I mean, one of the big faults, I think, in the Section 7 process is that there's been no time limit put on when, you know, Section 7s come to an end and we move to the next phase. And, you know, we've had considerable deliberations about whether to move to the next phase at SNH board level. The whole process is very time-consuming and costly to SNH to marshal the evidence and all the other information that's required to produce a solid case. I mean, we need a more streamlined process. Section 8, it is a shame that it hasn't been used and tested. I think if it was tested in court, we would know whether it was a workable power or not. As you indicated earlier, I mean, SNH said they were about to use it when they came to the Rural Affairs Committee in 2013. It hasn't subsequently been used. But we do need, as Simon says, we need a credible backstop. If people want decisions out there to be made, and then they can operate. And they may not like those decisions, but at least you've got a decision.
Okay. I know Mark Roscoe was wanting to develop the Section 7 theme.
Well, I was actually just going to briefly reflect on the voluntary approach, because we've got the public interest categories that are reported in the report. And my reading of this is that there's perhaps been some good work for the majority of the deer management groups around quantifying things, assessing the condition of our sites and the quality of the environment. But the gap appears to be in terms of delivering actions. Now, I know it's only been a, you know, two-year process that this has been analysed, but what's your thought on that in terms of how we drive actions? Is it a process of enforcing more Section 7s, or is it about, you know, driving through voluntary approach or whatever?
To be fair, we were on the go before then in some places. It's not just 2 years, is it? I mean, it was 2 years was the point at which this Parliament said, get your act together and set a review timing.
Just to add to that, actually, because when SNH looked through the 44 reports, they were giving advice on actions or addressing the public, giving advice to deer management groups. So whether they chose to follow the advice or not is reflected in what you see in those figures. And the other thing is that the AMBAs have not moved from 2014 to 2016. Now, it might be that if we had this where the onus was on the individual, so you'd probably get in some deer management groups where there's, you know, could be 80% of the landowners, land managers want to do the right thing, and so you deal with the other ones who aren't, and that's a process of fairness. And the other thing about this sort of approach is that it could equally apply to the lowlands. So if you've got road traffic accidents in a particular area, a hotspot, and you needed to, a landowner manager, whether it's the local authority owned land, they could be compelled to, or they could be asked to set some cull targets, mm-hmm. and then action taken if it doesn't happen.
Grant Moyle.
I think one of the things is that, you know, you asked about the deer management plans, and I mean, I've looked through the ones obviously for the Cairn Gorms area in terms of what they say, and I suppose what the issue you have is that they are variable in quality, and they, to my mind, the need around the actions has become more specific and more spatial. and that that's actually one of the key mechanisms, and it's probably the thing that needs to happen next, which is there are some good intentions in there, and actually they're a lot better than they were, so let's be very clear on that as well. But taking it from intentions to actually, well, what does that mean on the ground and who's going to do what, by what timescale and where, I think is the next, you know, that bit needs to happen as well. Now, that's happening in some places. You know, heard about, I think Drew mentioned this morning, about the wooden expansion stuff in the Mun Laoith. So it's not saying it's not everywhere again, but it's a question of, well, if there are people lagging behind in the voluntary principle, what do you do about that? And I think that, again, comes back to, well, what's your mechanism for if you like, shunting the ones that are further behind to make them actually do the things that we're looking for.
That's step change that SNH are calling for. Is that your interpretation of that?
Yeah, I think so.
We've touched on Section 7s there, unless anybody wants to add anything on Section 7s and their effectiveness. Let's move on to Section 8, Angus MacDonald.
Convener, obviously Section 8s have already been touched on in this session, and you'll have heard my question regarding Section 8s to the previous panel and my reference to Ian Rossi's comments. That SNH would be prepared to enforce Section 8 following an assessment, and many, I think it's fair to say, with a vested interest, share a frustration that no Section 8 has been enforced as yet. So can you tell us if there are any circumstances where, in your view, you would have expected a Section 8 power to have been enforced, and why you think they haven't been?
I think I echo what was said before. I think there's a lot of, the John Muir Trust been involved in two different Section 7s, in one in Breadalbin and one up at Ardvar, which was talked about before. I mean, there's a lot of uncertainty going forward as to what that would look like in terms of how it's open to challenge, how effective it will be, all the different owners that are involved. Is the Section 8 going to apply to all of them, or is it just going to apply to one of them? Is it going to apply to fencing? Is it going to apply to culling deer? What's it? So there's a lot of uncertainty, and I think for that reason, to be fair to SNH, given the powers they've got, I think John Milne in evidence a long time ago said he just thought it wasn't going to work, and he was the chair of the Deer Commission at the time. So I think there's a lot of uncertainty about it. I think it also comes back to this idea that do you try and deliver something on it's a very complicated way of delivering something, and a Section 8, if it's delivered, what does that mean? Is that a one-off cull that then gets imposed and then you walk away, or is it a long-term thing? Whereas the mechanism we've been discussing here is something that can actually, A, it's based on the individual owner, and they either are doing something or they're not, and B, it could repeat it every year, so they keep the pressure up. The fear about Section 8 is we spent years on this process, we get to Section 8, and a decision is made to reduce the population to X for a one-off cull, and then what happens? I mean, seems to be a very convoluted way of doing something. And I think experience, I mean, we've had deer management groups for 30 years, we've had deer management plans, we've had Section 7 since 1996, I don't know how well to say it, but obviously, for whatever reason, it isn't working, and it's not going to work. And so I'm not overly confident that the Section 8 is going to be the answer to the problem.
Dave Thompson. Dave Stewart, sorry. Apologies.
Thank you. Can I just make a general point? I'm not necessarily looking at the panel to reply to this. My general sense in Parliament is if legislation is fit for purpose, the agency charged to carry out should carry out, be that the police, the fiscal service, or whoever. If there's a sense that legislation is faulty or not fit for purpose, we've had examples of that with the Codder ruling and in tenant farmers, then it's up to Parliament to correct that legislation, and a committee can do that, or Parliament as a whole can do that. So I suppose the general point I'm making is you either use it or you don't use it. The idea that you think it has to be tested in court, if that was what we did for every piece of legislation, the courts would be full every day from now to the end of the century. I mean, that's not the way a legislation is planned to work. So I just make that general point. If the witnesses want to make some mention of it, that's fine. But I'm afraid I can't understand the general point SNH are making in this. No one has suggested so far the legislation is faulty. If it is faulty, the Scottish Government got space and time to correct it in a one-line bill going through Parliament. I don't know if Simon Pepper wants to respond to that.
If I may, yes, just briefly. I mean, I think the situation we currently have, because Section 8 is so cumbersome and has not been used for so many reasons, whatever those reasons may be, unfortunately, people pick up the signals of this reluctance, and what develops is a culture of impunity. That doesn't help progress. Mm-hmm. Indeed, I don't know if you've asked SNH how much money they've spent on one Section 11, currently threatening to go to Section 8, but it's a huge amount of money. I don't have the numbers myself, but it would shock you, I think. If we're going to go through that rigmarole for every Section 11 that might turn into a Section 8, we're finished. We're not going to make any progress.
That would turn into an 8.
Sorry, Section 7 turning into an 8. In other words, I think, you know, the analogy with a guard dog is quite good. If you've got a guard dog, but it takes you an enormous amount of time to let it off its leash and do its job, people will start ignoring that it's there. And we need an effective, nimble, straightforward, clear-cut, effective backup power. And the paradox of that is that it might never need to be used.
Angus MacDonald.
Taking on board Simon Pepper's point, would you not feel, however, that even serving one Section 8 would help to concentrate minds?
But if it's at the cost of, I don't know, £1 million, then you could argue that it's questionable value for money.
Taking that on a little bit then, what would each of you, I'll give each of you the opportunity, suggest would be the best way forward from this point on? If you were in a position to make recommendations, Simon Pemmer.
May I make a fairly clear recommendation? That is that I think we have reached the point where most of us would agree with the best will in the world that we don't have a system that is functioning smoothly. It's not delivering the goods. If it was, your predecessor committee would not have felt it necessary to light a rocket under the system and get things moving, as they clearly now are. But we many of us have doubts about whether it can still deliver the goods. So I think that the Land Reform Review Group proposals offer an extremely worthwhile avenue for further discussion between the necessary parties to come up with ways that the working of the voluntary principle could be improved, to make it easier for everybody. And I think this would be an enormous advantage to the deer management groups and to those trying to operate in the lowlands as well. And we need to be in a position, I suggest, where if there are still some elements that are not performing in 2 to 3 years' time, whenever we come back to look at outcomes again, if there are some that aren't performing, we must be in a position to be able to deal with that decisively. Otherwise, we're back into the same old going round the mulberry bush.
Duncan, or you?
So I think, you know, we're in a position now, we acknowledge there has been some progress from the deer management groups, albeit that's been quite late, even though we've had, you know, recognition of the public interest in wild deer and natural approach since 2008. But what we really need is a system of deer management that doesn't just apply to the 40% of the land area that is covered by the deer management groups. We need a system that covers all deer over all of Scotland. I mean, we have suggested, again, we would go back to the Land Reform Review Group proposals, putting the onus on the individual landowners to come up with a proposition that recognises the public interest, and then for SNH to consider that, agree with it or disagree with it. And we would agree that a sort of time-limited, short, task-led group with the basis of the Land Reform Review Group proposals and other considerations to come up with a formal proposition with the deer management groups involving FCS and SNH would be a good way to develop some more concrete proposals that might help sort out some of this mess.
Okay, Graham Wyle.
I suppose two very quick points. One is, I think there needs to be spatial articulation of the public interest, and I think that's really crucial at a level that people can understand and relate to in terms of flood management, in terms of all these other things, peatland restoration, woodland expansion, that then the deer management groups can then relate to. I think that's absolutely crucial. And that specific thing around Section 7 and Section 8 would be to see, well, are they fit for purpose? So there's probably two parts.
Probably no surprise that I agree with Duncan or Ewing, because we put in that response, and we'd very much like to be part of a short-term working group with a clear terms of reference and perhaps come back to the committee in 6 months with a solution.
Okay.
Mike Daniels.
I think I agree with all that. I just want to add a point that you know, there's also, in terms of the stalkers out there, in terms of private and, as I said, you know, public sector and NGO, you know, there's a lot of concern and uncertainty, and I think it, you know, the public interest isn't very clearly expressed, and I think that would really help to, you know, have SNH in a regulatory role where they're just saying this is what you need to cull, and everyone's clear. I mean, the deer management groups are in, you just end up with confusion and conflict, really, which has been going on for years, and I don't think that's really helpful to our rural communities.
Okay, well, thank you for those suggestions. I think that's, we'll wrap that up now. Thank you for your time, as with the previous panel. At its next meeting on the 20th of December, the committee will take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform on the Scottish Government's draft budget 2017-18. We'll also consider subordinate legislation. As agreed earlier, we will now move into private session. I ask that the public gallery be cleared as the public part of the meeting is closed. Thank you.